We'll do some Q&A, and I'll signal that. I'll say, hey, does anybody have any questions? But if we're running late and we have to jump to the next person, then we will have a Q&A panel at the end where everybody who's presented will be here to answer questions. So just be aware, that's the plan. But let me introduce Stu. Stu Besnoff has been a designer and installer of solar heating and hot water systems and off-grid battery backup since 2009. He began solar house design and construction in 2003. He has a master's of engineering from, help me with this, Rensselaer Polytech Institute, is a veteran of the U.S. Navy, and has been a member of the Northeast Sustainable Energy Association, the U.S. Green Building Council, the American Solar Energy Society, and many other professional and environmental organizations. He is also a longtime member of the and current chair of the Windsor Green Committee. Welcome, Stu.
Thank you. Okay, so I have 30 minutes with two topics. I'm going to try and go through as quick as I can and allow for questions. First thing is solar hot water. The water that comes out of your faucet in the kitchen, the bathroom, the bathtub, the washing machine is usually referred to as domestic hot water. And for many decades, solar hot water collectors have been used to heat domestic water. And what I'd like to do is get an overview first and then get into some of the individual components which I brought to show you, and then see about questions for that if I'm within the 15-minute time frame. Then we'll get into the small off-grid systems for electric. So, solar hot water collector, I mentioned already, it's the most visible item. Usually on the roof, could be ground mounted also. There's a couple of different varieties. We'll get to that afterwards, but the collector is the most visible thing. The next largest item is the water tank, usually in the basement. The water tank has a heat exchange coil. I did not bring a sample water tank. Empty, they weigh about 400 pounds. Typically, between 80 gallons and 120 gallons for the size. You may have a water heater supplied with electric, oil, or gas, and it's 40 gallons. Like, why do you need it so big? Is because when it's supplied with one of those fuels, that fuel's always there, unless there's a failure with the system. But when it's supplied by the sun, you want the water to stay hot overnight and into the next day if it's cloudy. So bigger tank, typically 80 gallons is the smallest. The rest of the system includes a circulator pump to circulate the antifreeze through the system. And there are some variations. I'm describing one way to do it, which is common. There's a few variations on how to do this. Circulator and a bunch of pipes between the collector and the tank. And a few safety devices. The temperatures and pressures are dangerous, so be sure to include safety devices. Okay, any questions about the big picture? Okay, I'll continue on. I mentioned domestic hot water. Solar hot water can be used for space heating and swimming pool heating also. It's less common, it's more expensive, and more equipment involved. So the domestic hot water from solar is more common. Okay, so let's zero in on the collector. You may have seen these big black things on roofs, usually two of them, 4 feet by 8 feet, and there's variations in those dimensions. They've been around since the 1980s or so. Some of them that were installed then are still working, and they can be serviced. If you have one of those that's not working, it may be possible to get it to work or get it removed, either way. The other style, more modern, but still around for more than 20 years, is the evacuated tube style, right here. This is a miniature. There are 5 tubes installed here. The real ones that are on my house have 30 tubes instead of 5. And each tube is a little more than 5 feet long, about this size. This is an empty glass tube. I say empty. We'll get to that detail in a minute. My finger is on the inner glass, my thumb is on the outer glass. And it's fused over on the top here. On the bottom, there's a nipple where the air was removed between those two glass tubes. So it's a vacuum. If you know how a thermos bottle works, there's a vacuum involved. So the heat from the sun comes from 90, well, actually, before I get to that, let me get to the complete one. I said it was empty. This is what's inside. This is called a heat pipe. It fits inside, and there's some thin metal spacers to keep it in the center. And this is the way they come fully assembled. There's a cap on top to keep the dust out, and that's all. It doesn't keep air pressure out. The vacuum is between the layers of glass. So this is the way they come with everything inserted. And yes, so the sun is about 96 million miles away. The radiation from the sun hits the black coating. The heat gets transferred to the heat pipe. It does not come out. There's a vacuum. There's no molecules to conduct the heat out. So it works well in the winter in addition to working well in the summer. Okay, so you can see that there's a big box up here. That's the manifold. The manifold, I have a cutaway, and there's a standard 3/4-inch copper pipe on one end, same thing on the other end. This miniature has fittings. It is functional. I've brought it to Earth Day festivals and heated 5 gallons of water with it. That won't work in here. Okay, so the manifold box has a manifold pipe. This is a short section of it inside. And this pipe has sleeves brazed in so that when you insert the glass tube up into the manifold, the heat pipe goes in. It's a tight fit. I'm not going to go all the way in. It goes in, and you have a metal-to-metal contact. So if you remember your training from school, we talked about radiation from the sun. Now we have conduction. When it gets inside the tank, there's going to be convection because the heat exchange coil on the bottom of the tank is at the bottom. And the clean water from either your well or public water supply the heat will rise and the entire tank will be heated. And when you turn on the faucet, you get hot water. Usually, there is a backup for your solar hot water. Most people, if it's been cloudy for 3 or 4 days, they still want a shower. So backup, you can use your conventional oil, gas, or electric water heater as the backup. Those will waste some fuel when they come on at midnight because there's no circulation going into them from your solar tank. This device, you may not be able to see it. This device is a tankless electric water heater. There are also tankless gas water heaters. This is an electric one. It will heat water for your entire house. So you may know the concept that there is a device in there that senses the flow. When water is flowing, it turns on the electricity. There's a dial to set your desired temperature. It's not lit up now because it's not connected to electricity. But you can set it to 120 degrees Fahrenheit and the water will come out at that temperature. If the water's going in from the solar tank at 120, that flow switch will turn on the device and it'll say, aha, it's already heated. No high voltage needed to heat it further. If it comes in at 90 degrees, it'll use a little bit of electricity. If it comes in at 50 degrees from underground, it'll use a bunch of electricity while you're in the shower. And when you turn the faucet off, it stops using electricity. You go on a long weekend away from home, no fuel wasted heating water while you're away. The sun may heat up your solar tank, and when you come back, you'll have plenty of hot water there. Okay, so that was the entire system. Any questions at all about solar hot water? Yes.
Hold on. I want to make sure the audience has a... Does anybody in the audience have a question for Stu? Because I have one for him if you don't. No? Okay. Two questions. Do you? Okay, go ahead.
How does the heat get from the black pipe across to the copper pipe if there's a vacuum?
Ah, good point. Okay, that's a good question. So the heat pipe... Well, yeah, I'm going to start from this direction. Okay, so your antifreeze is pumped up from the basement into one end of the manifold, and the antifreeze picks up heat from the first glass tube and heat pipe. And the question was, how does it get transferred? So this heat pipe gets the heat from inside the glass tube. If we were outside and the sun was hitting this, you'd put your finger in here and say, wow, it's hot in there. I had an exhibit at the Amherst Sustainability Festival, and the weather was like today. It was overcast, a little bit of mist, some clouds got thin a little bit, and the heat stayed in there. And people are walking around with their rubber boots on and their raincoats, and I'd say, hey, come over here. They didn't want to stop. I said, come over here, put your finger in here. And they looked at me like I was crazy. It's like, and they'd say, how did you get it warm in there? You have a heater here somewhere? It's like, no, the sun. Got through the clouds, got in, and the heat wouldn't come out. You can still feel it. So this, when it's inside, this gets hot. And there's a minimum tilt required. Most roofs are tilted. So there's convection that takes place inside here. It heats up, and the temperature, the pressure in here is set so that it will actually vaporize. And the vapor goes to the bulb on the top that fits tight here. So the heat inside here transfers along the whole length up to the larger section on the top and metal-to-metal contact to this pipe. And in case I didn't say it before, that these sleeves that it gets inserted to are brazed in, so you're not going to have water leaking through around this space here. So you get heat from the first one, heat from the second one, the third, all the way up to number 30. Did that answer your question?
I think she's asking about reverse transfer, how it keeps from getting back out once it's in.
The vacuum. So the radiation from the sun will go through glass. And once it heats everything up inside the center of the tube, that heat won't go out through the glass because there's a vacuum between the two layers of glass. And there's no molecules of anything to conduct the heat out. Yes?
My question is, I think you may have answered this already, that you don't need an active water circulation pump for this to work. It's passively circulating the water without that, or do you need one?
In most cases, the heavy water tank is in the basement, and the collector is either on the roof, or even if it's ground mounted, it's higher than the basement, and your source of heat is above your destination for the heat, so you do need a circulator pump. In some instances, I know there's one in Chesterfield for an off-grid home where it does rely on thermal siphon, where there's a hot item in the basement and there's a radiator in the living room, and it just goes on its own. It's off-grid, it's fantastic. It doesn't use up their battery supply. I've got one more minute for questions. Yes?
What's a typical residential installation cost?
Labor and material?
Sure, yeah.
Over $10,000. Before the federal income tax credit gets subtracted. Okay, so it's time to move on to the electric side of it. I understand there will be questions after all the presentations. Okay, so on the electric side, starting with what it's used for. Dan is going to present information about Gridtide. This is remote stuff. A small cabin in the middle of nowhere, a barn that's too far from the power lines, could be in the middle of the city where you don't want to go through the whole installation. I know somebody in Pittsfield with a slate roof on their house and a lot of trees nearby, but they wanted some kind of backup for their heating system. They have oil-fired steam heat and had a full tank of oil and power failure for 24 hours, and their house was freezing. Not anymore. They now have a few batteries, one photovoltaic module, and they didn't want it to be automatic, so there's a manual transfer. When there's a power failure, they can go in the basement and change it so that the batteries supply very small amount of electricity for the thermostat and the controls for that boiler. So remote location or very specialized small case for a home that is connected to the grid. Yeah, there's another example. I know it's in Chester, Massachusetts, where the home is close to a river. They have an unreliable municipal electric company, and the lights go out frequently, and there's a sump pump. And a homeowner wanted the sump pump to go during the storms. So, so their home normally is supplied by grid power, but if that fails, their sump pump will run from battery power. So that's what it's used for. So the slide says how it works. So the most visible thing is the photovoltaic module. This is a photovoltaic module. One thing about my vocabulary, I try not to say panel. Now, people have, so it's not wrong to say solar panel, but with what I'm presenting, you wouldn't know if I was talking about the hot water or the electric. It's like saying I'm gonna drive to town in my vehicle. Well, if you have a motorcycle, you can say motorcycle. If you have a truck, you can say truck. So I try to get more specific when I talk about the item that captures the energy from the sun, either a solar hot water collector or a photovoltaic module. So this is one relatively small photovoltaic module. Other components. And I mentioned battery. This is one small battery. You also need a charge controller. This will regulate the current that goes into the battery. And since I have limited time, maybe I should connect this now. Where am I? Okay, so. We have our charge controller getting connected to the battery right now, and it should light up, and it does, and it tells me the battery voltage is 12.6. Okay, because yesterday was sunny, it got charged. This was outside in front of my house yesterday. Okay, so, and if you're a do-it-yourselfer, you do connect in this sequence, the charge controller to the battery, before you connect the photovoltaic module to the charge controller. Which is going right now. Okay, so that's all connected. If there was sun coming through the roof, we'd be charging the battery. Not gonna happen today, because it's cloudy and the roof is pretty solid. Okay, so now that you got that set up, you can operate stuff that works on 12 volts DC. You could operate lights. I just brought in a fan, and I plug in the fan, turn it on, and the fan works. Okay, so I should mention, when I was talking about the solar hot water, I mentioned safety devices because of temperature and pressure being dangerous. There are safety devices required with electricity, and I am glossing over those because of the time limit. Just be aware that you must limit the current, have safety, either a fuse or circuit breaker in all of the circuits that you're connecting. Okay, so the fan works on DC. What if you have something that you want to operate on alternating current? You probably will recognize this as a plug for 120 volts AC house power. Well, you have to convert from the battery. So an inverter, they come in all different varieties. This is a relatively small, cheap one. And it will change from 12 volt DC to 120 volt AC. Again, I'm using the proper sequence. You connect it to the DC first, then you turn it on, then you plug in the load. And yeah, I could have brought anything from home. I brought the fish tank bubble gizmo, whatever it's called. Okay, and you reverse the sequence to turn things off. You take away the load. This doesn't have an on-off switch on it. Then you turn off the inverter. Okay, so let me just check my list, see if I skipped anything. Inverters, I mentioned the safety stuff. No, we can go to questions now. So any questions about, yes?
What's the battery chemistry?
This is a lead-based battery. I have seen lithium batteries in houses also, and this is a sealed lead battery. I've seen flooded lead-acid batteries. I have at my home flooded lead-acid batteries. I add distilled water every few months to keep them operating. They were there. Well, actually, I changed them because I used old ones. But when my house was built in 2008, before I moved in, there were batteries there for backup for the heating system. Lead or lithium, either one works. There's times where one is better than the other. And there's pros and cons. So depending on the unique situation or what you want to do, you get the one that fits your situation. Other questions about, okay, go ahead.
How many and how much space does the backup batteries, how big do they come and how long do they last? Like if you have one battery, would it heat an average house for 10 hours or 24 hours?
I understand the question. And first thing I want to say is that my presentation is the small stuff. And further down on the schedule, there's a presentation on your whole house kind of thing. Okay, so for the small stuff, it's probably true for your whole house. You design it based on the current, the amount of power required. I mentioned an oil-fired heating system in Pittsfield that I'm aware of. The requirement was in the under 150 watts, and the homeowner estimated how many times it turned. You know, the boiler turns on and then it turns off. Like, okay, it's got to be on. So that system was designed, I think, to go for 2 days with the number of batteries that are there. There's four of the old style lead acid batteries. It was a good fit for that situation. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay, and the person next to you had a question?
Yeah, I was just wondering, with the photo systems, is there a possibility or methods that can help with just taking a few circuits, simply removing them from the grid and using smaller batteries in a smaller system to just simply reduce, instead of you running the dryer and all the other things in the house, is it advantageous to do that?
Okay. So, Dan, yes. Is that part of yours?
I'll touch on it, sure.
Yeah, so We could save that one for later. So some people are really big on tree huggers. I like tree huggers, but it's like, okay, that's it. I'm just not going to do these lights on the grid anymore just to see if I can do it. And you can get something like this, and instead of a fan, have your lights or your fan. It's like, I'm just going to see if I can do that. And a year later, get a bigger system and run another room that has three lights or something like that. So you can kind of defect from the grid and do that. Or you can have some, and these things can be manually started or automatically started. It's a matter of budget. You can do almost anything now. It's a matter of getting the equipment and having the financing for it. Did that answer your question? Okay.
Stu, can I add something to that real quick?
Yes.
That's something exactly, both of your questions, that speaks to stuff that I've done. And there are two kind of things to consider. One is pure DC. So you could actually get a bunch of DC lights in your house on DC, separate DC circuits, and just power them with this, so there's no conversion, you don't lose efficiency there. But the other is a manual transfer switch at your breaker panel, where you just pop over the circuits that you want to run on the inverter off of the battery, or whatever you're running, or your generator even, but there's a way to do that. It's pretty easy. It's like a $250 piece of equipment. It's really easy to install, so.
And if you're using DC in certain parts of your house, and yeah, so you can no longer just switch over and use the grid exactly, but you can get a device that will change the 120 volt house power to 12 volt DC, and you can have backup. So you can do almost anything.
Questions? We have time. 4 minutes.
Hey, being ahead of schedule is good too.
I'm wondering with the instant or the on-demand electric hot water, I know they can, that's going to be a lot more expensive and challenging to install than just putting in a tank with electric backup.
Okay, so there are pros and cons of different kinds of backup for your solar hot water system for domestic water in your house. One of the lowest cost ways to do it is to have your 80-gallon or 120-gallon water tank, it's about 6 feet high and 2.5 feet around, and have your heat exchange coil in the bottom of it. And midway up, there's a standard electric heating element in that tank. That's what you're asking about. So that can be done. It has been done many times. The benefit of it, it's lower cost, it's simple, takes up less space in the basement. The disadvantage is that you don't really have an 80-gallon solar tank. You have a 40-gallon solar tank and a 40-gallon electric water tank, because let's say you had a good day yesterday and you take your shower in the morning before 7 o'clock and the sun gets really strong enough to make a difference at 9 o'clock. Well, the water in the tank cools off, and between 7 o'clock in the morning and 9 o'clock, you're gone to work, and that electric element for the top half of the tank heats the whole thing up to 120 degrees. Then the sun comes out strong and heats the bottom of the tank. And it doesn't rise because the top is already 120 degrees. So you're losing a little efficiency there. With a tankless water heater as your backup, you truly have your full tank as solar hot water. And it goes into that, and that only adds electricity when you need it. Another disadvantage of having the traditional electric resistance heating element is that if you take a long weekend and don't turn the circuit breaker off, you're going to be heating that while you're gone. So it can be done, and frequently it's the right choice. Look at each individual situation and see what's the best choice for there. I got 10 seconds left. Yes.
Using an indirect hot water storage tank that circulates the entire tank height,
and the whole column is heated, that's where this would be the most effective, I think.
You can get into, there's many varieties. You can use an indirect tank as a solar tank. You can hook your solar tank to another indirect and build up how much storage you have. Instead of getting one big tank, you can get two smaller tanks or three big tanks. Yeah, there's a lot of choices. And my time is over.
Thank you, Stu. Thank you very much. And just as a reminder for anybody who's just came in a little bit later, we will have a Q&A panel at the end. And I'm hoping all the presenters will be able to stay for that, if possible. So that if you have any questions that you think of after the fact, just ask them then. It would be beneficial for everybody to hear it. So now I'm introducing Tony Pagliarulo. So give me just a second. I got to introduce you, man. Yeah. Well, no, you can come on. All right. Tony Pagliarulo has been a resident of Dalton since 1985, thoroughly enjoying raising his family here. He is a former teacher at Dalton's Wacona Regional High School and has been active in the community, including being a current member of the Dalton Green Committee, where he has advocated for level 2 and level 3 electric vehicle chargers and successfully negotiated contracts for charger installations around our town. Tony has owned an EV for 2 years, is familiar with home charging, and will share his EV driving experiences beyond the Berkshires as well. Thank you, Tony.
Testing. Good. First time I've taken the stage since fourth grade, so my time has come. Thank you for being here. I just want to preface my remarks by saying that our Commonwealth has a grand vision in terms of climate sustainability, and by 2050, hopefully, we'll be zero or carbon zero neutral. Towards that end, I always like to start off a talk with any EV that by the year 2035, every vehicle sold by a car dealership in this state has to be an EV, not a hybrid. Certainly not a combustion, but 2035 is just about 10 years away. So it sounds like it's a distance, but it's going to happen, hopefully. I don't have any handouts, but I want to start off by saying that there are three internet sites that I would think you'd find useful. And the first is Green Energy Consumer Alliance. This is a nonpartisan, non-political group, which has been in around for some years. Matter of fact, their director came and spoke at our last climate fair 2 years ago, Larry Cretion. And they serve both Massachusetts and Rhode Island in terms of advocating climate change. And if you go to their website, I just went the other day, they are always updating information. The field is changing quickly. So this last venture on my part showed various vehicles and what the rebates were for our state and Rhode Island, what vehicles qualified under the credit, federal credits, etc. So I'd highly recommend that. That's the Green Energy Consumer Alliance. The other website, believe it or not, is the IRS. In the 2 years since I've purchased my vehicle, the IRS website has really updated information in terms of any identifying any vehicles that qualify for federal credits. And they've done a much better job of that. And finally, the last is our own Commonwealth, Mass MOR, and that's Mass Offers Rebates. And there's a distinction, of course, between rebates and credits. So those three sites, I would ask that you'd all research if indeed you're considering an EV. And the information is constantly in flux. I am an owner of a Bolt going on 2 years. My daughters own a Tesla going on 7 years. So we have some experience in our family with EV vehicles, and I'll share that with you. When I thought of this talk, my first thought, I woke up at night and I thought, boys, this is like fractured fairy tales. I don't know if you recall growing up, but I was a big fan of fractured fairy tales, and the story of EVs are sort of up and down, and hopefully it'll have a happy ending. So we hear information where there's a major push, and then we sort of a bit of a lull, but it's slowly getting to that end. I'm going to divide my talk today into three parts, the first being show me the money. The second being range anxiety or charging. And finally, some information that I hope you'll find interesting as EV vehicle technology has moved on. Let's start with rebates. Nothing has changed too much in terms of rebates other than what's termed the point of sale. Right now, Massachusetts offers a rebate, and you can apply for this within 90 days of purchase, and they're very good. When I applied for mine, it came with about 4 weeks' time. They were very efficient. They have a dedicated line and people dealing with that rebate. But any new or used cars now offer a rebate of $3,500. There are qualifications to everything I say here regarding rebates and credits. There are qualifications. So depending on whether you're married or single or filing jointly, that's all on the website information. But overall, in this state, the vehicle has to be a sales price of under $55,000. That rebate is also good for used EVs, although I think those are quite rare. But again, those vehicles would have to have a list price of under $40,000. And as I understand, you have to buy them from a dealer. That may have changed. I didn't look that up specifically. Your income has to be approximately under $150,000 in terms of a married couple. So again, be very careful in terms of any research if you go forward with this. If you are additionally income qualified, meaning maybe you're on MassHealth or you're on veteran services or something of that nature, you will receive another $1,500 as a rebate. And finally, if you own a vehicle that's 12 years of age or older, you will receive an additional $1,000 rebate. So when I say rebate, this is cash up front, regardless of your, you know, what your tax is owed, you're going to get that money up front. And I say it up front now because while the Berkshires don't have a point of sale, you can now go to the Springfield area, and if you purchase an EV, the paperwork will be filled out at the time of purchase. And it's just a savings, and it puts the onus is more or less on that dealer to submit that paperwork, but he has all the qualifying information. So this is a good thing rather than take it home and make your copies and send it to MOR. They'll eventually come through, but the point of sale makes it easier. I purchased mine from Bedard. They have not yet become a point of sale dealer. I will say, when I began my hunt 2 years ago or so, I would call up dealers, and within days, that vehicle would be gone. So I don't think too much has changed there. If you go around the lots, you're not going to see a lot of EVs. I put mine in on a special order. It did come through within 3 months, which both the dealer and I were surprised at, and it was a great transaction. Okay, trucks. Trucks are also rebated up to $7,500 in this state. So there may be a qualification. I know there is with the federal credit in terms of the price of the truck, but trucks being more, they take that into consideration. Heavy-duty trucks, and given the gross vehicle weight and the class designation, in this state, you can receive a rebate of up to $90,000. So that's quite a vehicle, but again, that's quite a sum of money to have rebated. The procedures are pretty much the same across the board in terms of rebating that money. You must live in the state, you must have a license, and you must keep the vehicle for 3 years. If you're in an economic justice community, and I'll make a point of this when I speak about the EVs in Dalton, and I don't quite understand the language here, but if your vehicle in some respect is used for business or travel within an economic justice community, and that is where income is 65% or less of the median income in this state, you will receive another 10% in addition to your rebate. And I think they're referring to trucks or commercial fleets in that respect. There are rebates that apply to government vehicles. I know New York City has a fleet of some 200 EVs, Pasadena, California. Their entire fleet now is EVs. I visited Nashville about a year and a half ago, and believe it or not, they have electric buses. And they charge by driving up on a platform, and somehow they charge from below or a hookup, and then they drive off. So there are EV vehicles across the board. And there are fleet discounts also, as I understand. Federal tax credits, another bonus. I would be wary here because a credit is not a rebate. So depending on your vehicle, and this is where the IRS site's going to become invaluable, they will list where they didn't, when I purchased mine, what vehicles qualify for what amount. So depending on your battery and your critical materials or critical minerals, I believe, you can have a split rebate of $3,750, upwards of $7,500. That credit is only good for the year in which you file, so you can't carry it over. So if I owe a tax of $5,000, well, I'll get my $5,000 knocked off, but that $2,500 isn't applicable to my next year's federal income tax credit. So again, be wary of that if you're installing solar, if you're installing a home charger, which I'll speak to, whatever energy credits, consider that in the year of purchase and the year in which you file. The federal government, again, will have qualifications. If you're married, for instance, it's under $300,000. The vehicle, I believe, has to be under $55,000, much like Massachusetts. Truck cap is $80,000, and there are credits for used vehicles up to $4,000. The paperwork I found a bit more difficult. I file my own taxes, but they have a form dedicated to that, and I think they've improved the form, to be honest with you. So that's where the money is, and that's constantly changing, and I'd ask everyone to consider that before they purchase an EV. Okay, one down, two to go. Charging or range anxiety. I've experienced range anxiety regularly whenever I take a long distance trip. I have to have my route planned. I have to know where my fast chargers are, which are level 3 chargers or level 2, depending on how long my stayover may be. It's a real phenomenon. I can tell you that one time I was driving home from my daughter's house in Amherst, and I wanted to test this and see what my vehicle could go, how far it could go, and I had to pull over in Windsor because my vehicle said, no, I would not make it home. I probably would have, but I didn't, and that's another story I'll get to. But basically, I pulled over to my in-law's house, and I charged up, and I had to use a trickle charge, but it got me home. So it's a real deal, but it's getting better in terms of the number of vehicles out there and charging stations, I should say. Okay, charging when you drive. EVs are quite different than combustible engines, where we can see how many miles per gallon one's getting. EVs, your EV is basically a large battery of different capacity, kilowatts, how much power it has. Mine is a particularly smaller one at about 60, 65 kilowatts, but they go up in kilowatt power. And basically, as you're driving, that vehicle is taking into account the terrain. So if I'm driving up a hill, I'm burning a lot of power. When I'm coming down the hill, if I use regenerative driving, which I'll get to, I can recapture some of that power. So depending on your trip, unless you're very familiar, you're going to be at the whim and call of the terrain in terms of how much power. If you are heavy-footed and you punch that pedal, well, you're going to drain that power that much sooner. So a constant drive is a better drive in terms of maintaining power. There are 3 levels of chargers. When you purchase an EV, you're going to probably be given, well, I think you will be given, what's called a level 1 charger. It comes with the vehicle, and it's a trickle charge, as I've mentioned. And this would go into a 120-volt outlet in your home. Better if that outlet is dedicated, because you are going to be consuming electricity on a regular basis. And as I said, it's 120 volts. If you trickle charge, you'll get, again, these are all approximate because I'll talk about temperature shortly, about 5 or 6 miles per the hour. So if you charged in overnight, 8 to 10 hours, you're going to pick up 50 to 60 hours, let's say, of miles, I should say, 50 to 60 miles for the next day. And that may be adequate for some people. When I purchased my vehicle, and I recommend this for everyone, you should definitely consider having a level 2 charger installed at your home. And these level 2 chargers can be both an outside or an inside installation. So most people that I know, myself included, I did an inside installation in my garage. These EV chargers, I use a charge point, but there are a number of chargers. Many of them are UL listed, and you should get a UL listed one. But in any event, these chargers are a dedicated line of 240 volts. And think of your dryer. Your dryer is a good example, or your oven for that matter. These are high-powered appliances, and you are using a high-power charging system because now you're going to add a lot of kilowatts to your battery. When you do a level two vehicles are not all the same. As I said, you can go from a dryer, say with a 30-amp dipole breaker, 240, 120, 120, 240 equals. You can go with a 40-amp, or in my case, I went with a 50-amp. And 50-amp is pretty much the maximum amperage or the breaker you would use for a level two charger. Again, dedicated. I mentioned earlier about UL tested. Well, I purchased a charge point, and I'm not plugging charge point for any other reason other than I believe that they do a good job. They have excellent service and they stand by their product. Well, I came home after a year and it didn't charge, and I said, "What's going on?" So I called charge point. They said, "Pop off the cap. It's very simple." And I took a picture, sent it to them, and the terminals had burnt out. And I said, "Gee, you know, it's been a year." He said, "Well, we're going to send you a new one. Pack up the old, send it to me, gratis." So I speak highly of ChargePoint because they do stand by their products, and that's not to discredit anybody else for that matter. But in any event, it was a simple matter of taking the three prongs and putting it in. They can be directly attached to the charger, or they can plug in. In my case, it was a plug-in, so I tripped the breaker. Not a big deal. It's not difficult. Okay, if you go with a 30, 40, or 50 amp breaker for your home charger, I mention that because given the cost of copper and wiring today, while the labor may be the same, those wires, that copper, can cost anywhere from $3 to $6 a foot. And so depending on where your electrical panel is, and assuming your electrical panel is up to speed, and I'll talk about monies there shortly, it's a major undertaking, you know, with a qualified electrician. But I would highly recommend you investigate that first, so when you come home, you're ready to charge, and that notion of range anxiety is gone. So I'll charge overnight, and I'll bring my vehicle right to capacity, and we're ready to go for several days, if not a week during the summer, and I'll get to the notion of temperature shortly. Okay, that will get me about 25 to 30 miles per hour on the charge. So if a trickle is 5 to 6, this will be approximately 25. I will say at this point, level two chargers, they are very typical around Berkshire County and around Massachusetts, if not the country. So outside the stationary factory, there's a level two charger. We've just installed some here at the CRA, which hopefully we'll be activating shortly. And I said level two chargers are not all made the same. So if I'm not mistaken, most level twos in Berkshire County, and I believe the stationary too, may be on a 30 amp circuit breaker. So that's fine. You know, it's dedicated 240. The ones at the CRA, however, will be at a 100-amp circuit breaker. And that's the maximum you can do for level two. So we're having, again, it's a terminology here, kilowatts. The ones behind the CRA will be at 19.2 kilowatts, just under 20. And I believe the one here may be 6.6 or 7.2. So I know mine is 7.6 at home with a 50 amp, maybe a little bit more than that, 9.2, maybe that's what it is. But in any event, the larger the breaker, the larger the wire, the more amperage you can do. So we'll be charging at a faster rate behind the CRA. Most aren't up to that speed. Okay, level threes. Here's where any long distance trip, you really have to plan accordingly. Level threes are superchargers, and these are 440 volts. So 120, 240, 480 volts. And basically, to qualify for a level three charger, you have to have 50 kilowatts of power. We're hopefully going to look in Dalton to be the first community to have level three chargers. And the only banks of level three are Tesla and one other just now at Simon's Rock College. But Tesla got ahead of the game, and you'll see they'll have banks of their chargers ready to go. And I'll speak more about how that will interact with vehicles that aren't Tesla vehicles. But in any event, these superchargers can only charge up to 80%. And the reason being is that if you charge that battery too quickly, you'll create damage. So between the charger and the vehicle, there's software that communicates with each other. And I'll speak a little bit more about that too. But basically, that level three charger will get you up to 80%. Basically, I've found it to be within 30 to 40 minutes. And that technology is improving. As new vehicles are coming out, some will charge up much faster. In 5 or 10 minutes, they'll pick up 100 miles. So it's getting better. It's much like the black and white TV. Things just got better as the technology improved and time went on. Tesla chargers, under the IRA Act, now have to provide a plug that would fit my vehicle. Every plug on an EV is somewhat different. So again, I'm going to use the analogy between beta and VHS. Tesla won that contest. So basically, it's termed a North American plug. It's a very simple plug, which I appreciate. But that Tesla plug won't fit my vehicle. So I have two options if I'm going to use Tesla. And I haven't used it to date because I found chargers that superchargers that do have the plug that my vehicle has. But basically, I can purchase an adapter, which goes on the end and ties into my vehicle. And GM now is offering those for, I think, $225. Ford is giving them away as part of their promotion. So again, doing that research. But Tesla is supposed to have plugs on their machines that should adapt to all vehicles as time goes on. And I think it's supposed to be the beginning this year or next year. It's been a very slow process. I think there's one station out here in Western Mass that has that plug that could fit my vehicle or vehicles that are non-Tesla. I said there's one other fast chargers, and that's at Simon's Rock College. They just had superchargers placed in down there. And when you look at a supercharger or even a level two, you'll see a post, and on either side of the post are the plugs. And those lines carry about 20, 25 feet. If it's a public, as we have behind the CRA, there's going to be an ADA accessible lane, and you should be able to charge up in public, whether it's supercharger or a level two. Let's see, limit, yeah. Okay, one other thing too. When you charge, you can use, for instance, in ChargePoint, I have a card and I swipe it, and ChargePoint sends me the bill via my credit card. I have an EVgo. I was allotted 500 miles through GM to charge 500 miles. I can use that, or you can use a credit card. If you're at a charger, and when I started, I didn't know much, but they always have someone online. You can call it in if there's an issue. There have been issues with level three chargers in terms of reliability. There's no doubt about that. Many times they're non-functioning for whatever reason. They have to be brought up to speed. ChargePoint, again, supposedly 95% of the time, they're on point in terms of being reliable and ready to charge. Another thing, too, is if you have the option to charge, I would strongly recommend you do it by the kilowatt, by the power that's actually being expended to charge your battery. Many places, and if you look it up, you know, on Google Maps or what have you, will list chargers, and then if you go into it, they'll also charge you by the kilowatt hour. I'm not as comfortable with that, and I say that because I'll take my car as an example. I have a 65-kilowatt battery. Well, I could tune in to a 350-kilowatt machine, but I'm not going to charge really any faster because my software is going to say, wait, I can't handle all that power coming in. So if I'm being charged by the kilowatt hour, and I think I'm correct in this, I'm going to be spending possibly more money than if I just did by the kilowatts I used. That's a poor explanation, but I'd always suggest you look at kilowatt hours. Something else I was going to mention here with charging. Oh, yes. Oh, temperature. Okay, so it's 80% on the level 3. My vehicle in the summer is a joy to drive. It's always fun to drive, but in the summer, I can charge up to 335 miles, and it's all a result of the temperature, the weather. Batteries like it when it's warm, not super hot, but when it's warm. On the coldest day in the winter, say end of January, beginning of February, I can only charge up to 185 miles on my vehicle. So the norm is about 250 to 260, just as GM promoted. Again, temperature is going to play a massive role in terms of your charge and your expending energy to get around. So I'll get to a tip in terms of a winter drive, but that's a reality. And it's not just a reality with my vehicle, it's a reality with all EVs. Terrain and temperatures, the two T words to take into consideration. Okay, I think that's got it. Chargers, yep. I had mentioned this somewhat earlier, but if you do have a home charger put in your home, you're eligible for a 30% credit. I think ChargePoint now is about $700, $750 for their level 2 charger, which can be adapted to either 30, 40, or 50 amps, so you have that option. Interior or exterior. That's a savings. I also understand that just recently, Eversource is also giving a credit of a rebate, I should say, not a credit, of $700 for a charger. And sometimes the dealer or the manufacturer will always also give you a credit. So GM offered to do mine for $500, I believe it was. But I had mine already installed. So again, I didn't do the homework. Could have saved some money, I gather, but so be it. Let's see, discount, not present. Okay. I think that's got it for charging and range anxiety. All right. Yeah, sure. I'll take any questions. Yeah. Okay. No questions. Okay. A couple things. I'll. Stu. Yeah.
So you mentioned levels of running out of charge in winter.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to tell everyone that the paperwork has been submitted for level 3 chargers in Windsor across the street from the town hall.
Fantastic. That'll make my drive that much more pleasant, Stu. Excellent. Absolutely. Thank you, Stu. Please. Michelle.
I have a question, Tony, about the... Hi. This issue was publicized during the two unfortunate flooding situations brought on by Hurricane Helene and Hurricane Milton. There was some reporting on the news about electric vehicles igniting as a result of being wet. And I'd like you to address that if you can. The other issue I remember from the winter time is out in Chicago, where a parking garage had a lot of exposure from the vehicles. It was so cold that the electric vehicles didn't start.
Yeah.
So if you could talk about those two things.
Well, I know, I don't know about the notion of getting wet. I don't know that, but I was going to speak about the notion of bi-directional charging, and that's something that did occur in the Asheville area of North Carolina, that they lost power. Well, newer vehicles now have something called bi-directional charging, and there are outlets in the vehicle. I know I went to a tailgate party up there at my college, and a gentleman plugged into his vehicle, and he had electricity. Well, the same occurred in Asheville. You can plug in, you have a giant battery. You can plug into that, and you can run your appliances, again, 120 volt, for days. Not hours, for days. So you have a backup generator. And that's another part of the technology that's evolving. I don't know about the wetness. I know Chicago had that cold. I can't speak to that. Obviously, if the battery does not like cold, I'm not denying it. I can certainly say that I'm glad I have a garage because I know my vehicle stays that much warmer, and I'll speak to about winter driving and some tips that way, what I found to be useful. So EV charging vehicles will have, or EV vehicles will have larger batteries, and that's an important consideration. I've mentioned the weather, the terrain, the weight of the vehicle. The less weight, the better the mileage. It's all based on, you know, how much you're pulling and what have you. Peterborough Pass. I like to tell this story about Peterborough Pass. You know where that is, I think, off of Route 7, going to Route 22. Well, I drive that on occasion, and I was going up the mountain, and I was burning a tremendous amount of kilowatts. And I reached the top, and I said, the second time around, I'm going to just note what this took. And it basically took about 25 miles off my vehicle to get up to the Peterborough Pass. Well, given that earlier incident of Windsor, I decided to use what's termed regenerative driving. And I didn't like it at first. It's a little button you push in the car, and it feels as though there's a bit of a drag on the car. There really isn't. But because of regenerative driving, I drove down the other side of Peterborough Pass. Well, of that 25 miles I had lost, I picked up 16 miles. I'm saying, this is great. It took me, 9 miles to get up, but okay. I drove another about 4 or 5 miles on Route 22 North, and it's like, this is really, it's almost a break-even point. I said, that's great. And so regenerative driving is something that every EV vehicle has, so you can charge your vehicle. So for instance, my wife says not to do this, but I'll come up to a red light, and I'll purposely just cruise into it, and because of the friction or whatever, if that's not the right term, but the resistance, my vehicle will cruise right up with very little braking. Sometimes I don't brake, and that's not a good thing because the car behind me doesn't see me hit my brakes. So my wife keeps telling me, hit the brake. But in any event, it really does add up. So I don't drive unless it's called one pedal driving. It's regenerative energy, and it really does work. Tony, I didn't do that before Windsor, but after Windsor I did.
Tony, thank you. This has been great. And
wait, let me just finish up. I got to finish up. Quickly.
Okay. The question also of costs. I found that EV driving, EV vehicles, cost me generally one-third less than the price of gas, and I have a pickup, so, I can sort of do that equation. You don't see garages for EV vehicles because pretty much the only thing that's going to be done are tires and brakes. It's a software package of anything that may have to be updated, which can be done on the internet, which invaluable. You'll have to have your phone in your car, especially for apps. Bidirectional, I mentioned. It's quiet. It's the peppiest vehicle you ever drive. It's instant torque. There are no gears. So when you push that pedal, you're going to pop right away. And finally, charging stations are improving. Rhode Island will be the first state in New England to take advantage of the National Vehicle Electrification Infrastructure Project. They now have fast chargers all along 95. Massachusetts is gearing up to do the same. And finally, I'd ask you, if you can, Eversource doesn't do this, National Grid does, always advocate for charging in the evening where rates are reduced. If you can advocate for that, it's when electricity costs less money and it will cost you less, given our cost of electricity in Western Mass, to reduce your cost to charge your vehicle.
Okay, thanks, man. That's okay. Thank you, Tony. Tony Pagliarulo. I thought he did a great job. Yeah. Thank you. and now we have, I'm going to introduce him. Is he already coming up? Oh, come on up, Dan. and by the way, just as a reminder for those who may have just walked in, we will have a Q&A session at a panel at the end. So if you have additional questions about EV charging, Tony is going to be here and he can answer them. So just be aware of that. Introducing Dan. Dan Britton has been working in the New England solar industry since 2008. He is an NABCEP certified photovoltaic technical sales professional, has extensive experience designing grid-tied solar photovoltaic and battery backup systems, and offers a thorough understanding of the Massachusetts landscape of solar power advantages, state and federal incentives, and residential photovoltaic return on investment. Thank you, Dan.
Let's see. Okay. 30 minutes to talk about grid-tied PV and battery backup. I'll try to gloss over some things, and then if there's questions that you want to talk about more specific stuff, we can do that. Sorry, this looks a little different on here, and I want to make sure we're looking at the same thing. Okay. So this is kind of an overview of what I'm going to talk about. Like I said, I'm going to gloss over some of that more than others. First thing, this was already mentioned several times. This is important to really understand electrical stuff. And it's really important as we start driving EVs and things become more electrified. There's a difference between power and energy. You hear the terms kW and kWh used interchangeably, and they're not the same thing. kW is power, which is, you can think of, a common analogy is this water coming out of a pipe. Power being the sort of an instantaneous amount of water or force that's coming out of that pipe. And then energy on the bottom is how much water you end up in the bucket at the end of, you know, some period of time. Power interchangeable with something like horsepower. So if you have a car engine, you know, that might be a 200 horsepower engine. That would be equivalent to something like 150 kW. So an electric car might have a motor in it that's 150 kW of power. That's that instantaneous amount of power or horsepower. Energy. You can think of as an amount of energy. It's calories, for example, is an amount of energy. You could convert kilowatt hours into calories. I don't know what the conversion is. But a gallon of gas, which we're all familiar with, has about 34 kilowatt hours of energy in it. That's a lot of energy. Where that's what's so appealing about fossil fuels is it's very energy dense. A typical EV battery has something like 50 to 100 kilowatt hours of energy in it. So in reality, there's only like 2 or 3 gallons of gas in an average EV battery. Even the bigger ones, you know, might be 3 or 4. The difference, of course, is an EV is multiple times more efficient operating than internal combustion engine. So if nothing else, if this doesn't make sense to you, just know that there's a difference between kW and kWh. And it's important in terms of solar because the terms get used a lot. Little quiz. If you're using 1500 watts or 1.5 kW a microwave for 2 hours, how much energy does that use? So if your Eversource bill, if the only thing you used for the month was this microwave, for 2 hours, you would get a bill for 3 kilowatt hours. It would say 3 kilowatt hours multiplied by all those little charges on your bill. And that would be, what, 90 cents? Something like that. Okay. Power versus energy. Important to think about. Grid-tied solar. I'm sure that most people have seen solar PV systems, photovoltaics, around, you know, compared to solar hot water, as Stu was talking about, you know, we're typically talking about covering a much larger area. You know, it'll be covering most of a rooftop. The way these systems generally work, some of them have batteries, some of them don't. They do not need to have batteries. The sun is shining. The solar panels start producing electricity. That is direct current electricity. Photovoltaic panels, PV panels create DC power. That goes down into an inverter. Sometimes there's an inverter on the side of the house. Sometimes those inverters are on the back of the panel. And that inverter takes that DC electricity and turns it into 240 volt AC electricity, which is matching essentially what you're getting from the utility. From there, the power is then just fed directly into your house. And so if the sun is shining and you're not home and you're not doing anything, the electricity goes in your house, but then it goes right back out through your meter and actually gets distributed into the grid. If you're home doing something, you got lights going and running a dryer or whatever, you're just going to be consuming that energy directly on site. And I think I have the next slide that shows. So an important thing in Massachusetts is that we have very good rules about net metering. And so I should say that this generally only applies to the investor-owned utilities, National Grid, Eversource, Unitil, the municipal light plants, Chester, Westfield, Holyoke, there's South Hadley, there's a handful of others. They get to make their own rules around this, so that doesn't apply in this case. In Dalton, it's going to be Eversource. So the way net metering works is that it's very convenient in that you don't need to worry about when you're using energy, how you're using anything. It just it nets out essentially at the end of the month. So this is a sample net metering bill from Eversource, and you can see these two lines on there says purchase and sales. And so all they're doing is reading how much you're importing from them, which is mostly going to be at night, and then also how much you're exporting back into the grid. At the end of the month, they take the difference, and then you either owe them for the difference or they owe you and by in the form of a credit. So it doesn't matter. You can use as much energy as you want at night. You know, you don't have to think about what time of the day you're doing things. If you want to do it for purposes of, you know, trying to consume behind the meter for, you know, sort of environmental reasons, you can do that, but it's not necessary as far as your billing goes. And essentially, you get a one-to-one credit in Massachusetts. It's not exactly a one-to-one credit. There's, as you probably know, there's a lot of different fees on in your bill, a long list of them. It typically, that credit typically ends up being about 90% of what you actually pay. In some cases, it can actually be more if you have an alternative supplier that is lower than the basic fixed service. The net metering credit that you get is actually tied to the what they call the basic fixed service, the standard supply rate. So if you have an alternative supplier that is dramatically lower than that, you can actually get more, which is sort of a new phenomenon with the deregulation of that. Another important thing. So net metering is big because it doesn't require, it means that you don't need batteries, which is important. You don't need to think about anything. The grid is still there. It's still you still have power when you need it. You can turn a dryer on in the middle of the night, you know, whatever. It doesn't matter. That doesn't mean that the system's going to operate when the grid goes off unless you have batteries. So it's not designed to be a backup source of power unless you do have batteries. Incentive-wise, so we have some pretty attractive incentives, especially in Massachusetts. Net metering, as I mentioned, is a big one. The systems are state property tax exempt. They're also sales tax exempt. It does have to be your principal residence in order to get the sales tax exemption. So that doesn't apply if you're doing a system on a second home. And then the tax credits. The tax credits are the big part of the incentive. There's a 30% federal income tax credit. And importantly, the tax credits are not rebates. They are tax credits. So you have to have the sufficient tax burden in order to use the credit. The solar tax credit does carry forward, so if you don't have a sufficient tax burden in 1 year, the balance does carry forward over multiple years. The state tax credit is similar, but it's capped at $1,000. It's 15%, but they cap it at $1,000, so most people don't have too much trouble using that one up. There's also these things called renewable energy certificates. I'm not gonna get into that too much. They're not particularly valuable, a few cents a kilowatt hour. I generally recommend people just think of them as sort of icing on the cake. But you can get a few hundred bucks a year, depending on the size of the system, from those. Let's see. Okay. What is, you know, and, I, you know, people often say, how much does the system cost? It's kind of like buying a car. You know, you can buy a car for $10,000. You can buy a car for, I don't know, $200,000. There's a lot of variation, and it really depends on, the biggest variation is in the size of the system, so how many panels you're putting up. Complications of the site are definitely a thing, too. So it's going to cost more if you have a three-story, 12-pitch roof versus you live in a ranch that's a 6-12 pitch. You know, it's just going to be less labor to do it. So, you know, there's variation. This is kind of an average standard, you know, house that we might do. So if your total system cost is $31,000, you're going to have a federal tax credit of $9,300. The state tax credit is the $1,000, and then your net investment's a little over $20,000. So typically the tax credits are going to cover something like a third of the system cost. And you know, this is for a typical 8kW system that, you know, depending on how much sun your roof gets, if it's facing due south, there's no shade on it, you're going to get more than if it's facing slightly east or west, or, you know, has some shade on it. The next one, show you what that looks like in terms of numbers. You know, the benefits from that system, you're talking about something like $2,500 a year in electric bill savings. You'll get a few hundred bucks from the REC revenue. Typical system's going to pay for itself, and, you know, depending on how good your site is, it's going to be somewhere in the 5 to 10 year range right now. The system's going to be on your roof for 25 plus years, and I'll talk a little bit more about that in a bit. It can also be ground-based. And then, of course, there's the environmental part of it, not, you know, getting clean, renewable energy. Financing. So I would say at least half, if not, you know, more of our customers are using some sort of financing, and I would guess that's the case for most people doing solar. You know, most people don't have $30,000 burning a hole in their pocket. And so this has come a long way in the last, so I've been doing this since 2008, and in 2000, you know, even really going back 7 years ago or so, there weren't really good loan options to do solar. And now that has changed a lot. A big part of that was the Mass Solar Loan Program that the state operated for quite a while. That got a lot of the savings banks and credit unions comfortable doing solar lending. And so now you can get a solar loan from any number of credit unions, just like a car loan. And it's, you know, it's not tied to the equity in the house. It's the system is the collateral itself, and it's a working loan program at this point. It works in that the payments will be less than what you're paying the utility if you've got a good site, and assuming you can use the tax credits. So for that, just to give you an example, that 8kW system, if you're talking about a 20-year loan at, you know, an 8% interest rate, it's going to be something like, most of the way the solar loans work is that they give you an introductory period for the first 15 months or so, or first year, and then they're expecting you to get the federal tax credit, apply it to the loan, and then the payment drops. And so in this case, it would be something like $210 a month. And then after you apply the tax credit, it'd be $185 a month for the long-term loan. And that's for a system that's going to save you about, you know, $205 a month. So, you know, in this case, you're going to be something like $20 a month better off paying that solar loan than you are paying Eversource. That varies. Sometimes that differential is $100 a month better off, and sometimes you're not better off because your roof doesn't get enough sun, or your installation is so complicated that it just makes it more expensive. But for a good site, and if you can use that tax credit, that, you know, you'll often be better off paying that loan payment than you will be paying Eversource or National Grid. One other thing that I don't have a slide for, but it's worth mentioning, is that, as you're maybe aware, there are a lot of companies that will do leasing and third-party ownership, leasing and power purchase agreements. They tend to be the companies that are knocking on people's doors and trying to get you to sign up for something. I would recommend that you use caution with those arrangements. They're not all bad, but the bottom line is you are better off owning the system directly, getting the tax credits and getting all the incentives yourself, and then ultimately not having to pay anything to anybody. The leases and the power purchase agreements, typically the way those work is the company owns those systems. They get the tax credits, they get all the incentives, and then they just pass along 5 or 10% savings to you. Those arrangements, unless you cannot use the federal tax credit, you're going to be better off owning the system through a loan. So there are, you know, there are some situations where you might be better off if you can't use the tax credit, but they're pretty rare. That said, if you're in a situation where you can't use the tax credit, my recommendation would be to sit tight. The Mass Clean Energy Center is going to roll out a program at some point in 2025 that is going to be targeted towards people specifically that can't use the tax credit because they're on the lower income spectrum. So there will be some pretty good options coming for you soon. Any questions on that before I start talking about battery storage, which I got 9 minutes if I'm, go ahead. Yes, so the commercial stuff, he asked about tax credits and benefits for businesses. So the short answer is yes. There are some variations in that. The 30% tax credit does apply to businesses. It is technically a different tax credit, so there's some nuance around it that's slightly different, but it is ultimately a 30% tax credit. If commercial installations also qualify for accelerated depreciation, so it can be quite attractive for a business to do. It gets a little bit more complicated depending on how big of a system that you're talking about. The interconnection rules get more complicated the bigger you go. But the incentives to apply for businesses is going to be a very attractive thing to do. Any others before I start going into batteries?
Can you explain the fluctuation in SREC refunds?
SREC program?
They fluctuate. Can you comment on that?
Yeah, so, well, I should first say that the SREC program, there's SREC 1 and there's SREC 2. These are incentive programs that are no longer in existence, or at least you cannot get into them now. So I think this is 2019 or 2018. Was the cutoff point. So it's probably not worth spending too much time talking about it. But they're market based. They do have a floor and a cap in them, but similar to the RECs, they're all driven. The value of them is driven by the renewable energy portfolio standards that the state sets. So if there's an abundance of clean energy, REC prices are going to drop because there's more supply of the RECs. And if there's lower amounts, then or the demand is higher because they're being required to buy more of them, then the prices go up. But those are pretty complicated markets. All right, let me get into battery storage.
And Dan, just yeah. So you know, I'll try to catch up on my segment, so you have till 2:35.
Okay, 2:35, five extra minutes. So battery storage, this is kind of a hot topic. Everybody seems to be interested in battery storage for better or worse. And I don't want to be negative about battery storage. The systems have come a long way, and they're really amazing in some sense. And so this is different than what Stu was talking about, in that generally speaking, we're talking about backing up the whole house or part of the house, a critical loads panel. It really just depends on, there's site specifics, but it really depends on how much money you want to spend on a battery backup system. So the good news is that the 30% federal tax credit applies to battery systems, and that includes, so you can actually do standalone battery systems now, and the Inflation Reduction Act changes so that the standalone systems also qualify for the credit. In Massachusetts, with Eversource and National Grid, there's also this program called Connected Solutions, and this is sort of I'd like to think of it as the future of the grid, in that the idea being electricity is really expensive at certain times of the day. We don't realize that. Well, we realize it because it all gets averaged out, but we don't pay real-time rates as residential users because we don't all have time of use meters. But the reality is electricity is much more expensive between roughly 3 o'clock and 7 o'clock or 8 o'clock, because that's when we all come home and we start using stuff. And also, the sun starts to set, so all the renewables that we have on the grid start to go off. They call that the duck curve. So there's a lot of interest in using battery storage, whether that is standalone home battery storage, whether it's in EVs or whatever, to mitigate that and start discharging power into the grid at those peak times. And that's what this Connected Solutions program is all about. So if you participate in Connected Solutions, the utility will actually coordinate with the manufacturer of the batteries to discharge those batteries during peak times, and then you get paid an additional incentive to do that. It's a fairly complicated incentive structure, but you know, it might be something like $500 to $1,000 a year, depending on the size of your battery system. When you participate in Connected Solutions, you can also use the MassSave Heat Loan, which is a 0% interest loan, to finance the battery system. So that's another big incentive, up to $25,000. Can't go more than $25,000. And the real big benefit is that it's clean, quiet, automatic backup power. So unlike a generator, it's similar in that there's an automatic transfer switch mechanism, switches over, and then you have, you know, clean, quiet power, and you might not even know that the power went off unless you're looking at your phone at the apps. Challenge-wise, fire code requirements have gotten very difficult in the last couple of years, actually, where we can put the batteries. You asked about the flooding. Certainly, batteries are not designed to be submerged in water. They can be mounted outdoors now. I can get into that specifics. Some of them can be mounted outdoors in New England and deal with the cold temperatures, but you are storing an amount of energy. So it is, you know, you can think of it as a tank of propane or a tank of oil. You have stored energy in a box somewhere. It is, you know, something that you want to consider as far as fire goes. I do not know of any instances of systems being an issue in terms of igniting on fire in somebody's house. But certainly if your house caught on fire in some other way, you'd want to be careful about exposing, you know, those batteries to fire. Because they could, if there's fire burning around them, they are probably going to, it could be a problem, certainly for the firefighters. So there's been a bunch of changes to the fire codes. If you're going to put batteries inside your house now, in Massachusetts, you need to put them in a fire-rated enclosure, which basically means a sheetrocked utility room with a fire, not extinguisher, smoke alarm. So we are now increasingly putting systems into outside, and I'll get into that in a bit. The other parts are weather expectations and costs. You know, they're not inexpensive systems, and I'm a little bit reluctant to get into cost just because, you know, it's even more variable than the PV systems themselves. The main limitation, of course, is if the power goes out, what do you want to be able to run? Instantaneous power, like how many, like do you need to be able to run a dryer? Because that's a big load. That's a 5 to 7 kW load. That's going to require a lot of battery storage. Or do you just want some lights in a refrigerator? And then the second part of that is, how long do you want to be able to operate on your battery storage? And the more and the longer you want to go, the more expensive it's going to get and the bigger the system you need. This is the specs of a Tesla Powerwall 2. They've now moved on to the Tesla Powerwall 3. But it's useful. It's kind of, they've kind of become, this is kind of a normal reference point for other systems, but a Tesla Powerwall contains 13.5 kWh of energy. So that's roughly a third of a gallon of gasoline amount of energy in it. And it can put out 5 kW of continuous power, backup power. 5 kW is roughly like what a dryer would use, an electric dryer. So if that system is running at full tilt at 5 kW and you've got 13.5 kWh of energy in there, anybody tell me how long that's going to run for if it's running at full power output at 5 kW? Yeah, something like 2.5 hours. A refrigerator, for example, is going to use about, 800 watts, and it doesn't generally run, you know, continuously. So you can run a refrigerator a long time. But if you're trying to run heat pumps or a dryer or charge your electric car, Not so much. Let's see. Let's see. 229. Any questions about battery storage before I talk about this stuff, which is important? Yeah.
Oh, thanks, Jack. Just one. Do you know anything about iron now? Iron batteries as storage? It's sort of new, but it's supposed to be much safer and reliable in some respects?
I'm not super well versed on battery chemistry and technology. I know that, you know, a lot of them are moving to lithium iron phosphate batteries versus the lithium nickel manganese cobalt NMC batteries. I don't know exactly why that is. The NMC ones have traditionally been the more, you know, they're all after power, you know, energy density and being able to store more and with less weight, especially for EVs. But for in the last couple of years, it seems like most of them have moved to lithium iron phosphate batteries, at least for home storage batteries. I don't know. I think there's some mine, you know, the concerns about mining are definitely a thing, especially with cobalt. I'm probably not the best person to answer that question. Yeah.
That I think is going to work for my house, and I have solar panels already, and I'm producing more power than will be stored in the battery. Will that go back out to the grid?
If you're connected to the grid, yes. So the way the systems work is that if you are connected to the grid, then there's an automatic transfer switch with the battery backup systems that we install. So if you're connected to the grid's operational, everything's going to work like you normally would as far as the solar goes. You're going to push electricity into the grid as needed, and then pull from it however. When the power goes out, the transfer switch will detect that, and it'll flip over and isolate you from the grid completely. And so, you know, then you would be operating in like an islanded off-grid system where you'd be charging your batteries, discharging your batteries, depending on what you're using, what the sun's doing, and all of that. And there's also, you can operate the battery backup systems. There's a different setting that you can operate in self-consumption mode. You can basically set the battery so that it just stays charged all the time. In Massachusetts, since we don't have those time of use rates, it really doesn't make sense to do the self-consumption mode and that stuff. But in other states where you have, you pay more at different times of the day, it can pay to actually run the battery to try to consume as much behind the meter as possible. Let me get into this stuff just quickly, because this stuff I think is important, you know, sort of real world considerations around doing solar and battery backup. But just some really, you know, important things you want to think about. If you're putting a solar panels on your roof, you want to think about how old your roof is. The panels are going to be up there a long time. They have 25-year warranties on them, and they could theoretically keep producing after that. Ideally, you don't have to pull the system off your roof and then reinstall it. We have been finding that, you know, for systems that are now 15 plus years old, it just makes more sense to take that system off and put a new system up for a couple different reasons. But it's best, you know, to not have to deal with that removal and reinstallation factor. Structural engineering, if you live in a house that's 200 years old and the rafters are timbers that, you know, are weak and you know, maybe not up to modern codes, you know, it's roughly 3 pounds a square foot, so it's not a huge amount of weight, but especially up here in the hills, snow loads are a bit higher, so that's a consideration. Utility interconnection, you can't just put any system on your house that you want and tie it into the grid. Eversource and National Grid have to sign off on it because you will be ultimately backfeeding electricity into their grid, and there's some considerations there. And then there's warranties around the equipment that you're installing, and also from whoever's installing it. And the other last thing I'll say is homeowner's insurance. So nobody's warranty is gonna cover if a tornado comes and tears your roof off and everything with it, nobody's warranties are gonna cover that. So it is something that you should consider having covered under your homeowner's insurance, just like any other appliance or device in your house. So I think that's all I got. I'm gonna leave it at that, and I'll be around later for questions if you have any. Good to go?
Dan Britton. I'm going to switch this over myself here.
Okay, yeah, go ahead.
That'd be great. Thank you.
All right, so this is Todd Logan. He'll be, you know, talking about how to select contractors for any project. Todd offers 20 years of project management experience for residential and commercial construction and maintenance, including physical plant systems design, contractor supervision, and installation inspections. He's currently a resident of Dalton and a member of the Green Dalton Committee and volunteers in other projects for the town as well.
Thank you, Jack. And just so everybody knows, this is Jack Crow, who comes to us by way of Lori Martinelli from Wakona. And he's been kind enough to volunteer today to help us, and he's been great so far. So thank you, Jack. Let me get my PowerPoint up. Hold on just a second. Time and be done by 3 so that Blue Strike can come up and do their presentation. But this is basically, for all the stuff that we've talked about, and this is not going to work. Hold on. For all the stuff that we've talked about, you're going to need to hire a contractor, right? And in the Berkshires, it's a little bit challenging. Finding experienced, licensed, and reasonably priced contractors, you know, I've lived in a few different states, 4 different states, mostly in big cities, and I've done projects in all of those cities, construction projects, including solar PV installs and other things. And here it's quite a challenge to get even the simplest work done, as I'm sure anybody who's tried to have, you know, even plumbing or electrical or getting a new roof, it can take some work. So the sources, often what I found so far, and you probably already know this, those who've lived here a long time, is that word-of-mouth referrals are really the best. Google search results, generally what you end up getting are the people who are self-promoting. So the people who need the business, are those the people who you want? We'll get to that later, how to qualify them. But one gold mine is lists that towns have of their contractors who are authorized to perform work for the town. So I actually found my roofer through the Pittsfield's list of authorized and qualified roofers that the town of Pittsfield use. And that worked out very well. And then, of course, getting 3 competitive bids is an absolute must. But being persistent is key. It took me, just to get my roof done, took me 1.5 years and 6 different contractors before I finally found someone who would actually do the work and follow through. So. Vetting the contractor is really what this presentation is about, is are they licensed, are they experienced, proper insurance, are they pulling the permit or asking you to do it, their current lead time, providing a written contract, their payment schedule, which is usually on the contract, good ratings and complaints, I'll give you some sources for that, and then asking them for a list of referrals, just maybe 2 or 3 people they've recently completed work for that could give them a good recommendation. By the way, how visible is this to you out there? Can you, in the back, can you actually read this? Okay, all right. I just wanted to make sure. Of course, in Massachusetts, contractors are actually required to provide their license number on their business card and on their website. If it's not on either, that's a kind of a red flag. There's an online licensing guide, and I'll show that to you. Actually, here's like the top of the list, but it lists the type of work. Do I need a construction supervisor to supervise it, or can I get it just done with a HIC, home improvement contractor? Do I need a permit? Does a permit need to be done? And then comments, the comments are really useful. This is a great document. It's easy to find. If you just type in that search string at the top, Massachusetts, who needs an HIC and who needs a CSL, basically, you'll find this document. But it's really helpful because it also says, well, for an electrician, well, it needs to be a licensed electrician, obviously, right? So For trades, you have specific licenses. Experience. This is my personal standard, and you know, I've had to let it slip a little bit here when I've tried to find people, but I like to have somebody who's been doing that work for at least 5 years, has 3 years using or installing the service or product that they're recommending, and has completed things locally where I can actually check it out. I can go look at it or, again, talk to the customer. And then, and this is a difficult one. Are they doing the work themselves, or are they subbing it out to a subcontractor? You will see in the Berkshire County, you'll see a lot of contractors who only have 3 members of their company who do all these really big projects. And the way they do it is they sub it out to another company, and they just add a profit margin on top of it. So you're probably not going to get as good a deal, generally speaking, number one. But number two, there's less of you don't really have a relationship with the business who's actually doing the installation because they're pulling in somebody else. So I always recommend just ask, hey, do you sub out or do you do it yourself? Proper insurance. Can I just see a show of hands, how many people know what a COI is? 1, 2, 3 people. Okay, 4. Okay, good. So a certificate of insurance is a, well, actually, I'm going to forward and show you what it is. It is this. It looks just like this. Anybody who does work on your home should provide you one of these without being asked. This is not something you should have to ask for. And in fact, when the bid comes in, when a quote comes in, it should just be attached to the quote. The only difference for the contractor is that if, in terms of just giving you a boilerplate one of these and giving one that's specific for you, is that when you sign the contract, they will give you another one. Actually, it'll come from the insurance company directly or their broker, insurance broker directly, that'll list you as a named insured in the bottom left of that COI. And I don't know how many of you have ever seen one of these before, if you didn't know what it was, but you should have seen one if you'd had any work done on your house by anybody. There's a reason for that. Why does it matter? So in the state of Massachusetts, and I'll bring this up, the state building code says that the homeowner can act as the general contractor for any work that's done at their house, okay? Which is great. That means you can pull the permit if you want. You're entitled to that. Even if you're not licensed, that's what this says, you can still get the work performed. You can supervise a licensed contractor, right, who's doing it. That's great. It sounds good, right? There's just one problem with that. You're liable, not the contractor. If you pull the permit or they don't have appropriate insurance, and one of their workers falls and down the stairs and breaks their leg, your homeowner's policy is going to have to pay for that. If they damage something in your house, your homeowner's policy is going to have to pay for that. It's not on them. You can't go to court and plead it because the Massachusetts code says you should have known that you needed to get that COI, that proof of insurance, to ensure your own protection. If you didn't get it, then you as the homeowner have 100% liability. It doesn't matter who did the damage or who got injured. That is especially true with permits. So let me just. I have had no less than 3 reputable, recommended, experienced, very competent contractors ask me if it would be okay for me to pull the permit here in Dalton. I don't think it's nefarious. I just think they would love to not have the liability, right? So never pull the permit yourself as a homeowner, ever. Always have the contractor do it. And if they insist, that's a red flag. That means they probably don't have insurance because to get a permit, again, remember, you as the homeowner don't have to be licensed. But they, as a contractor, do. If they go to the permit, they go to the town and they apply for a permit, it has to be, they will have to prove their own licensure. I also like to ask people to show me the permit, or I check with the town. You can do that actually yourself here in Dalton. You can check to see if the permit was filed. You can even ask to be emailed when they submit the permit. There's a little box in there here in Dalton where you can just put in homeowner's email, and then they'll actually, it'll automatically notify you. Yep, I think I'm remembering that right, but I did get notified. Lead time. So lead time is, this is the hardest thing. And I'll put Dan on the spot right now and ask, what is your current lead time for a residential 15 kilowatt solar install? 3 to 4 months. That's really good. Some of the other companies I've spoken with, well, we can get you next spring, you know. A well-run company that's doing a lot of business and does its own work in-house can do a 3 to 4 month lead time, and it doesn't send up a flag at all for me. But oftentimes, the folks who have the longest lead times are the ones who are in the most demand. They're smaller companies. Stu, can I ask you, what is your lead time for water? But if it was a new install for a hot water system, out of curiosity. Okay, all right, sorry to put you on the spot. Gotcha. Okay. Stu was really good coming to my house, though. So when I needed him to help me with something. So, but lead time can be a little bit, I met a guy out in, is it where? Am I saying that right? Yeah. Who they have a big factory, old textile factory that they're converting to business space. And he had put in all of the HVIC and all of the mini splits, you know, upgraded all the electrical, was repointing all the brick on the outside of the building. And I'm just like standing there with my jaw dropped and just going, this is incredible what this guy is able to do. So I asked him, I said, are you available for residential? He says, yeah, you know, if it's a large enough project. That's another thing to remember. Larger the project, the more likely you're going to get good competitive quotes, because then they know they're going to make some money off of you. But I said, so when are you available? And he went to his phone and he looked it up and he goes, well, if you've got a larger project, my first availability is about 3 years and 2 months out. That happens. I do say the longer the lead time, the lower the initial deposit should be. I'll talk a little bit about that in a second on the contract thing. Do they provide a contract? All contracts are negotiable, but everyone that you do business with should have one. I mean, word of mouth's great if it's somebody doing your yard, but if it's somebody who's putting a $36,000 PV array on your roof, a contract is probably a good idea. That details the scope of work, total price with payment schedule, start date and completion date. Usually those are estimated, especially out here, because things happen, weather, other things. Labor and material rates for additional work, if approved. So there'll be a little statement that says, if we need to do something additional, you will, as the owner, approve whether we move forward on that, and the cost of that will be this, you know, this per hour, generally, is how that works. Provisions for canceling the contract, if necessary, are nice to have. There's also force majeure clauses and other things in there that protect them. But there should be equal protection for both you as the homeowner and for the business. It shouldn't be one-sided. Payment schedules. This is where I get in the most trouble here in the Berkshires. I used to live in a state where the maximum deposit was either 10% or $1,000, whichever was less. That was the law. And I'm talking $80,000 commercial solar installations. Didn't matter how much the project was. $1,000, that's all they get up front. Now, if you have a really long lead time, then you know, I don't think putting more than $1,000 down makes a lot of sense anyway. And I've told people that. And honestly, contractors that I've spoken with here, in the, they're usually okay with that. They're like, yeah, since I won't be able to start for 6 months, you'd only have to pay me $1,000 now. Which is, I think that's okay. But I've also had people come and say, I need 50% down. And I won't be able to start till next fall. You should know that's illegal. Massachusetts law says that the most a contractor can charge you for an initial deposit is 30%. They can't charge you 50%. And in my experience, unfortunately, the ones who do that, the ones who say, it may be that they're just really overwhelmed, and they're doing that to push you away because they don't need the business. They've got too much business already, and that happens. But some of the time, it also indicates that since they're breaking the law, they're not particularly ethical, or they're not educated about the law. So that's, neither of those things are good, clearly. So the payment schedule that I like is 1,000 bucks down. The next big payment I'll make is 100% of what the contractor says the materials are worth. So they show up at the house, drop off $5,000 worth of lumber and, you know, other stuff. I write them a check right there. Or all Venmo, I don't care what, it's sitting in my driveway. Why would I care? You know, I'm not worried about that because I'm not worried about them not completing the job because I own those materials. So that's the next big payment. And then usually start of work, you know, when people start working at your house, it's good to have another, you know, an initial payment. And there might be progress payments along the way. But then you shouldn't have to pay for that work until it's done. If somebody's coming back to you constantly saying, oh, I need another couple grand. I'm just having trouble paying my guys, you know, whatever. Oh, okay, so they don't run their business very well. But there's another issue there. Whatever you pay them for work that hasn't been completed is just, you know, you're paying for vaporware. They can just walk away and they've just taken your money. Now, I don't think, my experience is that most people who are in business, especially if they've been in business for a long time, they're fundamentally ethical. They want to do what's right for their customers. They're not trying to scam anybody. But you guys know there was that contractor in Pittsfield, if you read in the Eagle, who just would take, he would take 50% down and then just disappear. So it happens. So to protect yourself, it's always a good idea to have that contract, know what the payment schedules are, and then withhold. Personally, I withhold payment until my punch list is done. And that means after I've inspected it, after I've made sure that what we agreed to in the scope that's written in the contract is actually done, and I'll just say, hey, I'm sorry that I can't pay you the whole amount, but you only did 25% of the work or 50% of the work that we agreed to. So that's the toughest one. That's why this is the walking on eggshells one, because you don't want to alienate somebody who's honest and trying to do what's right for you, but then again, you don't want to open the door to somebody who's just going to take you for granted. Before I move on from that, did that make sense, or was I just rambling incoherently? Okay. Thank you. Ratings and reviews. Here's a big surprise for me, having lived in four other places where using Yelp or using Google ratings to find a contractor was actually pretty helpful. That's not true here. I see five-star restaurants who are closed, and all the people who gave them five stars are people who are friends and relatives. I went to school with them. I grew up with them. You know, they give them all these positive reviews, and who knows if they've eaten at the restaurant or not. That's also true for contractors. You just don't. Yelp doesn't even have contractor reviews. I'll see some listed, and there's just nothing there. So it's really tough. So that's why going back to the word of mouth referrals, finding out people who've actually used them is really good. BBB, I'll give you just one example. Anybody know who Modern Concepts is down in Tampa? Dan, did you know about these guys? Okay. So they were solar scammers, and they didn't complete projects. You see this, I don't know if you can see it, but The alert at the top is basically describing all the unethical things that they used to do. You see the rating is F, which is unusual because they're not an accredited BBB business. Usually you don't see a rating because if they're not accredited, it just is not accredited. But this one actually says F because they're so bad. By the way, it's A, B, C. A and B and C are all acceptable. And then you see 34 customer reviews and 2 stars. I don't usually go by those, but the Better Business Bureau website is a great place to get information about a business. You can see how long it's been in business, and you can see complaints and how they were resolved. It's very helpful. Let's see. And then, oh, yes, the state of Massachusetts actually keeps records of complaints for home improvement contractors, HICs, or CSLs, which are the next level up. You can just Google it, and it'll come up as at the top of the list, Massachusetts contractor complaint form. It also has a link that shows you where to go to find out about complaints about previous folks. What's great about these is that there's real money for people, like with home improvement contractors. If somebody did abandon the job and they have they had a home improvement contractor's license, there's a fund that can pay you back if you file a complaint in a timely manner. I don't know what the success rate is of getting those claims paid, but that's what the fund is there for. So you can look up those HIC complaints. And again, word of mouth is great. 3 customer references. This is a funky one. You know, I don't know how, you know, when I had my own, I've had several businesses, but when I had my consulting business, I wouldn't have wanted to give, previous ones. Why? I want all of my customers to think they're the most important person and that no one else exists, because that's kind of what they think anyway. So I never really would do this for an ongoing consultant relationship. But this does make a little bit more sense for a home improvement installation or a solar installation or battery backup or whatever, because it's one and done. You're done. They've done their service, they've done their installation, you know how they're acting in an ongoing way with issues that have come up. So I would always ask and then make those calls. My red flag, if not, why not? You know, simply, why wouldn't you do that? So not everybody is going to respond to these the same way. I think they're reasonable, but I also did business for 40 years in other states, 30-some-odd years in other states, where these were reasonable. These were expected, normal, nothing new. Out here, I've gotten some pushback from some folks who actually turned out to be really great people. They're like, why are you asking me that? Nobody ever asked that. So there is that issue. And so maybe not being too self-righteous and overly adamant or accusatory when asking for these things, being nice about it, but simply saying, hey, my understanding from my attorney or my understanding from a consultant I talked to or whatever is that I should be doing this. Is this okay? You can put yourself in that situation. And generally, they'll go, oh, yeah, no problem. But patience and persistence are necessary because even when you get promised these things, it doesn't necessarily mean they will manifest. So being patient is important. And that brings me to 3:00. So I'm going to, Jack, can you introduce our next? Okay. Jack's going to introduce our next person while I get his computer set up. But thank you very much. Again, if you have questions for me, we'll get to those in the panel. Thank you so much.
Up right now, we have Rich Swanson. He's going to do the intro for the Dalton Climate Action Plan and Community Survey. Rich is the director of the Energy and Climate Division at Blue Strike, the consultancy Dalton has hired to help us produce our 2025 Climate Action Plan. Rich and his team bring decades of collective experience in environmental strategy and innovative approaches in order to help us reduce our carbon footprint, including consulting on climate action plans in 36 states and 4 plans here in Massachusetts.
Thank you. Thank you for that nice introduction. Thank you, Todd. It makes me glad that we were selected as a contractor for the town of Dalton, so coming from such an expert. It's great to be with you. I was a little bit late here today, but I drove in from Reading, Mass., which is just north of Boston, and it's just so beautiful to be here in the Berkshires. Really appreciate you coming here and being here with us all. It's been a pleasure so far to work with the Green Dalton Committee over the last several months. I'm going to give you a little bit of an update on our progress, what we've been doing, and talk about our overall engagement here today. But first of all, just a little bit more about me and about Blue Strike. As mentioned, I drove in from Reading. We've lived in Massachusetts for about 20 years. I moved from Boulder, Colorado with our family for a different job back then. And have been working with Blue Strike for about 3 years, 3 or 4 years. Prior to that, I did mostly energy economics. So I'm an economist by training and by background, and have worked in sort of different parts of the world evaluating energy projects and policies and sort of tariff designs, different things like that. Blue Strike, as mentioned in the introduction, does climate action planning, energy planning, sustainability planning, those types of efforts for a lot of different communities. We work with towns, cities, counties, universities. We've actually done a lot of work with universities in the past, helping them on what we call a decarbonization pathway, which is just another way of saying reducing their fossil fuel dependency, and also associated with that, reducing their emissions, which comes from burning fossil fuels, over time. And so, in fact, that's what the town of Dalton has hired us to do, is to work with you all as a town, especially through the Green Dalton community, in coming up with a plan, sort of a roadmap, to reduce the town of Dalton's overall emissions over time. And so this presentation is basically put together to explain how we're doing that, how we're developing that plan, what some of that means, and I'm going to walk you through a little bit of the process. So, as mentioned, what a climate action plan, that's the CAP acronym there, is meant to do is to be a series of strategy steps to achieve emission reduction targets. So the idea here is the state of Massachusetts, the United States in some senses, depending on whether we're in or out of the Paris Accord, for example, but for sure the state of Massachusetts has set certain emission reduction targets. And so those are targets that the state hopes to achieve in terms of all of its overall emissions. And I'll talk a little bit about what emissions means and what those are here in just a minute. But the state has set these targets, and sometimes they change, sometimes they accelerate over time. And so we're talking with you all as a town about potential targets in the town of Dalton and then strategies to achieve those targets. We're also talking with the Green Dalton community and with you all about ways to reduce the impact of the town's operations on the overall environment here in Dalton and the Berkshires. So a few of the CAP deliverables that we are working on is, number one, a greenhouse gas inventory. I'll explain more about what that is, but in a nutshell, that is an accounting of the current level of emissions or greenhouse gases that are being emitted by the town currently. We will also develop a list of prioritized strategies. These are things that the town can do to reduce that quantity of emissions over time. And then third, we're going to present the town with a residence guide. These are things that every resident can do to help the community overall reduce those emissions. And then we'll also deliver an implementation plan. This will be part of the overall effort here. What an implementation plan does is it takes the discrete strategies and action steps that are enumerated, that you all hopefully have helped generate, some that come from best practices and other places, and it will set a schedule of those types of activities for the town to follow across the years, usually between now and 2050, when most carbon reduction goals are set. So that's essentially what we're doing from a sort of a 30,000 foot level for the Climate Action Plan and the town of Dalton. A couple of goals that are implicit in those deliverables and in our overall engagement are to educate folks on what climate impacts mean, what climate, there's sort of two sides of climate-related activities. One is called mitigation. That has to do with reducing sort of what I've been talking about, really, reducing the overall emissions that we as humans produce. And the other is adaptation. That is, how do we adapt to the effects of climate change in our own communities? And so we want to educate folks with how to do those two things, both mitigate climate change over time and adapt to its effects. We also want to empower people to take action by giving action steps and by collaborating with you to figure out what are the best and most appropriate steps for the town, and identify those strategies specifically, and then make recommendations of programs and policies based on particular criteria that we will discuss here in a minute. So the Climate Action Plan will deliver customized strategies in a few key areas. And I'm just going to read you here some of the things off of this slide. But basically, we have boxed or created about four buckets here that list. You can sort of think about these as major topics under which our efforts will be collated and enumerated. The first is buildings and efficiency. So when we heat or cool our buildings, of course, that produces, because we're burning fuel to do that, that produces some emissions. And so we can reduce those emissions by increasing efficiency within those buildings so that our heating and cooling is more efficient. Sometimes by pulling in energy that is from a clean source, as we heard from Dan earlier about solar PV. So we might see some strategies like renewable energy procurement, energy efficiency measures, sustainable materials and designs, all in that larger category of buildings and efficiencies. Then we have another category over here called transportation and mobility. And Tony gave us a great presentation about electric vehicles, what it's like to sort of use, operate, purchase, procure all of the things that are necessary for an EV. And so to reduce our overall emissions from transportation and our efforts of just getting around, we may see some strategies in terms of vehicle electrification, some goals to pursue as a town. We might see some stuff on other active transport policies, and so we're going to take a look at that. The third category in our overall framework here is green community, and we'll take a look at a few community-wide efforts, biodiversity, sort of what to do with our natural spaces, community engagement, things like what we're doing here today, engaging with the town directly. We're going to talk a little bit about a survey that we have that we would love for you all to take and hopefully to tell your friends to take as well. And then the fourth category we have over here, resource conservation, is another area where we can both reduce those emissions and adapt to the impacts of climate change. So we'll talk about how to reduce, for example, our solid waste that we produce as a town. Solid waste, when we put it in a landfill, it can emit a lot of particularly methane, which is a greenhouse gas. And that is very potent, and it also keeps on coming out of that landfill for a long time. And so as we can reduce our solid waste, then we can reduce those greenhouse gases over time. And so that may be that this resource conservation is a category, and there may be some strategies in there that we can talk about specifically for the town of Dalton. With our own engagement as Blue Strike with the town, we've got a little bit of a timeline up here. We started a little bit later than June. We sort of got pushed into the beginning of August a little bit, but started doing some baseline review, information gathering. Then we move in and are just sort of finishing up now our data analytics and forecasting. This is part of kind of a Dalton-wide community engagement effort, and this will extend here into, you know, sort of early to mid-November. We will put together some draft goals, frameworks, and strategies, and then eventually we will come up with some specific strategies, working with you all to do that, and we will put those all together in a plan that we should be able to deliver here in early February. So this is sort of our timeline and key milestones. Our overall approach, I'll just read some of these things to you, but we really operate in three distinct phases. One is we like to tell a data-driven story. And so this data-driven story, what that means is that we collect and analyze data, we do an inventory and a forecast, and we also set targets. So we want to understand what's really happening here in the town of Dalton. What fuels are being used? What patterns are emerging? Where are most emissions coming from? Why is that important? All of those kinds of things, that's our data gathering phase, and that enables us to sort of tell a data-driven story. And so that's really phase one, where we baseline that based on existing data, things that we can observe. The second phase, which we're really in now, is we want to uncover the needs and values of your community, of the Dalton community, and we do that through engagement activities like this, through our survey, through other discussions, through meeting with the Green Dalton team. And the purpose, really the overall goal behind that, is to try to build a bit of a coalition here in Dalton for the activities that you know, you want to see as a community. And then the third thing is we want to work together with you to create strategies. Sometimes we refer to them as crowd-pleasing strategies. We hope they are. We want strategies that sort of have a broad appeal, that everybody can sort of see themselves in, that they feel like, you know, if we participate together here, then all of Dalton wins. And so those are our three phases, kind of this data gathering baseline phase, then our engagement phase, where we really want to open up a conversation with the town, and then third is that strategy coordination, co-creation phase, where we want to come up with the best plan for moving forward. So in our outreach and engagement portion, we want to try to make sure that this is really your plan. This is the plan of Dalton, and we believe that every plan sort of tells a story. It tells a story of a community, where you are, where you're going, and a roadmap for how to get there. And so we want to ensure community ownership. We want to prioritize solutions based on criteria that are important to you. We want to try to engage with as many of the community as is absolutely possible. We want to increase awareness. And once again, the goal is really to try to build some momentum for the plan moving forward. Some of our primary engagement activities are this climate fair, the community survey, which we will have a little bit later on, and then our Green Dalton committee and our communication with them. So I know, at least I think I speak for everybody on the Green Dalton Committee, that they would love to hear from you directly and are here to sort of interface, bring your ideas to the table. And so that's a very important part of our engagement activity. I mentioned we're kind of wrapping up that first phase, which is a kind of a baseline phase. And so we have conducted our first, we'll consider this a draft because we always refine our data a little bit after we get the first pass. But this is a picture right now of Dalton's current emissions. So you can see there in the box, this says 101,000, and then it has those letters, metric tons of CO2 equivalents. So this is what we call a greenhouse gas inventory, or GHG inventory. And there are essentially three greenhouse gases that we're counting here. One is carbon dioxide, which you are probably familiar with. That's the CO2 in that acronym right there. The second is methane. I mentioned that methane really comes, there's a lot of it from landfills, but it's also embedded in the emissions of other things, the cars we drive, the natural gas we burn, those kinds of things. The interesting thing about methane is it's quite potent, but it doesn't last quite as long in the atmosphere. It tends to last for about 20 years and then to start to, you know, sort of dissipate a little bit, whereas carbon dioxide lasts a very long time in the atmosphere. And then the third one is nitrous oxide, if I have the chemistry right. And what we do is we convert those last two, the nitrogen and the methane, into a carbon dioxide equivalent through an equivalency formula. And we bring all of that into Dalton's total emissions. And so you can see here on the side, I'll read these percentages to you, but community-wide, Dalton has about 6.5% of its overall emissions from waste, and a lot of that is, most of that is coming from a capped landfill that was capped quite a while ago, but still emits. Transportation is about 21%. That's the green bar on that far side of that donut circle. And then what we call stationary energy. This is basically electricity and then natural gas or other heating fuels from both residential, commercial, and industrial associations here in the town of Dalton. And that accounts for about 72% of your overall emissions. In this, we put a little bit finer point on it, and you can see there the green transportation. And then I'll just briefly point out that this portion of the blue section, which is associated with that 72% over there, this comes from residential buildings, and then this portion comes from commercial and industrial buildings here in Dalton. So this just gives you a picture again, first pass. We take our data from government sources, usually the Mass Save program through the state of Massachusetts. And so they do some aggregating. And so sometimes we can't disaggregate entirely, but at any rate, this is the first, this is the data that we've received so far from MassSave. This breaks our energy use down, so that big portion that was commercial, residential, and residential, commercial, and industrial energy, this breaks this down into its sources a little bit more completely. So you can see fuel oil is about 14%. Electricity is about 34% of that total, and then natural gas is about 52%. So most emissions is coming, at least in the stationary energy component, is coming from natural gas. And then this further breaks it down a little bit. This is residential natural gas here, commercial and industrial natural gas here. This is residential, this is commercial electricity, residential electricity, and then this top one up here is residential fuel oil, which is about 13% of that total from energy. So that gives you a little bit more detail, a little bit more color about the energy-related emissions, or I should say stationary energy-related emissions, because there's also transportation, and I won't go into all the details and breakdowns of that particular category, but thought I'd give you this additional color here. So from here, where do we go? Well, one thing we will do with the committee that we're working with is we will take a look at all the Massachusetts goals and do some benchmarking. We'll look at comparable Dalton towns and do some benchmarking there. What are other towns? What's expected by the state in terms of reduction targets? What are other towns and communities here in the Berkshires or in other places in Massachusetts doing? And then we will try to set and identify feasible yet ambitious targets, and then track initiatives and projects progress over time, or that will allow us to track progress over time. We'll also do some emissions analytics, determining costs, timeline, feasibility of certain reductions, and then get into the reduction strategies to meet those various targets. I mentioned that part of our engagement will take a look at all of our different strategies and prioritize those strategies. The criteria that we use for prioritizing is really up to you. It's really up to the town. This grid allows us to vet or rank each one of the strategies that's developed according to those criteria. And so you can see here up at the top, the most important part of this is really sort of what's at the top or what could be up at the top. And so you can see here in this second column here, GHG reduction potential. Again, that's greenhouse gas reduction potential. And we can rank all of the different strategies that we arrive at by that reduction potential, and then give it sort of a high, medium, low, or sometimes with some strategies we can get in there and calculate specifically over time, if you implement this, you would expect to see emissions decline by a number and be able to rank them that way. Secondly, improves quality of life. So this seems a little bit more subjective, it certainly is, but we can ask you all, you know, does this, if we implement this, does this improve your quality of life over time? What do you think? And we can rank that high, medium, and low. Reducing operational costs. This is always a key component for municipalities, any jurisdiction really, is if we implement this particular strategy, will it over time reduce our operational costs? So you noticed in Dan's presentation a little bit earlier, he compared the cost of paying for your electricity versus paying for the loan that you might secure to install a PV system on your roof. And so that's an important criteria. If we can reduce operational costs, then obviously that goes in the plus column. And then is there funding available? Maybe another criteria. We'll look at all the different strategies, match those up with particular funding concepts, sources, both here in Massachusetts, federally, and just sort of, you know, yes or no. Obviously, those that have direct ties towards funding become more operational faster. They're more actionable. And so we come up with this prioritization grid. We can rank those. And then what we like to do is we like to try to put the low-hanging fruit first. So these are things with a big impact, low cost, or funding availability. And those go first on the timeline, and we say, hey, let's see if we can get those done quickly. Those are going to have a big impact, and then we'll move forward to some of the ones that might be a little bit more expensive, take a little bit longer, require perhaps a few more man hours, something like that. And that's essentially how we work through our prioritization process. In the end, Dalton will get a plan, and you'll have a few expressions of it. The most basic expression is a planning document. Once again, You know, that might sound kind of boring, but we hope it tells a story. We hope it tells a story of, again, where you are, where you're going, and how you're going to get there. And so this is an example of a plan that was developed previously. This one here, one of our key strategies was operate sustainable municipal buildings. And then there are some goals here associated with particular building efficiencies. The first one says reduce municipal energy use by 30% by 2035. And then some strategies that are set up to do exactly that, auditing the city's facilities and conducting a comprehensive energy efficiency upgrade. There are also some co-benefits that go along with that. Another goal in this particular case was to install solar and battery storage at city facilities, and there are some action items associated with that, as well as some co-benefits that went along with that. This was also attached, again, to a timeline for implementation that, in this case, the city had agreed on. And so our next steps are to continue sort of this community engagement season while we're reaching out to you all and trying to get your feedback. Then we will eventually turn a corner into strategy design, some goal setting and strategy design with the Green Dalton team, move forward with that. So we've sort of advertised this strategy or this survey. We're going to get to that, I think, a little bit after the panel. But maybe I will stop there, and I think I have just a few minutes for questions if you want, and then I know there's a panel discussion later on if you have additional questions. So let me go ahead. There was a lot of information right there, so apologies for that. But let me go ahead and just stop here and see what questions you might have. Yeah, David. I'll wait for you to get the mic, David.
I mean, reality check is doing this is not going to save the planet or humanity, but in Dalton. But if we go on a larger scale, can you comment on how many other towns in the country or across the world are doing these kind of activities?
Yeah, that's a great question. So starting with the U.S. and sort of policy in the U.S., you'll recall that the Paris Accord set a target for us to reduce, sort of globally, and national governments, many national governments, in fact, most national governments got on board and said, we want to try to achieve targets such that the temperature rise is less than 1.5 degrees. Many scientists feel like we're sort of past that point and that instead a more realistic target is less than 2 degrees. And so the US has extracted itself from that accord, that agreement, and then gotten back into it. So that's on the national side. The state of Massachusetts, as you know, has certain, a big part of these goals is renewable portfolio standards that Dan mentioned earlier. And Massachusetts has instituted those so that we get more and more of our electricity energy from renewable sources, and then has set its own targets in terms of statewide goals. Inside Massachusetts, I don't know how many towns have set or cities have set specific goals, and I'm not sure exactly how many towns are in the state, but if I were to guess, I would say probably 30 to 40% of the towns either have or are in the process of setting these kinds of targets. And I think many more will come, particularly with state mandates and state goals that really affect municipal operations, but then extend their way and sort of their influence into the city, into the community at large. In the US, about half the states have renewable portfolio standards, and within those states, there's a greater tendency for towns and cities, counties, to do plans like this. They're less frequent in states that have not adopted those portfolio standards and or in states that haven't adopted their own targets. As you might imagine, the Northeast and the West are ahead, in terms of addressing this particular issue, with, a smattering of states in the middle America that is also working forward on the issue. Yeah, other questions? Yeah, I'll wait for the mic, I think, for the video.
I have a question about the questionnaire that residents are going to be asked to fill out. It occurs to me that a number of people might need some sort of context. Before they answer a question, they may need some background information that will accompany the questions asked of them. For example, when you talked about quote-unquote natural gas and, the fact that one of its components is methane, yes, I know that I've learned over the course of years that methane dissipates more quickly. Its harmful impact dissipates more quickly than CO2 in terms of environmental impact. But it warms the atmosphere 60 to 80 times faster than CO2. And that is really an important number for our residents to be aware of. And so that's the sort of thing that, I would appreciate the questionnaire including in terms of background information. Also, people, because 50 years ago, natural gas was more natural than it is now. I mean, a major component of what is called natural gas is fracked gas, which is loaded with contaminants. And I think a lot of people don't know that.
Yeah, thanks. Of course, so thank you. That's it's a great question and a great suggestion. When we're going to dedicate some time to take the survey later on today, and one of the reasons that we're doing it here is to collect your feedback on the survey as a tool. And so as you take it, if you have feedback for us, we'd love to hear from you. So you can write that down for us, or you can talk to me about it or any one of the Green Dalton team folks about it, and that would be very helpful. Secondly, we are more than happy to provide a link or something like that that's associated. We can host it on the town website or something like that, where we have some background information about terms in the, in the survey. We have tried to define some things that we feel like might be particularly arcane or, technical, and so we want to try to address that as much as possible. Thirdly, you're right. I appreciate your insight into natural gas and its component parts. Certainly, there is a wealth of information and education that goes along with all things climate related, and we feel like you do that the more we can communicate about that, the more that people understand about that, the better. And so, that's sort of part of the overall engagement, I guess, is to try to communicate as much as we can with this sort of limited climate action planning engagement, to the town of Dalton and that people would come to a deeper understanding of why these things are important. For example, why is it important that natural gas contains methane? What does that mean? Why is it important that it contains other contaminants, and how is that affect us? So, yeah, thank you very much for that. I appreciate it. I think I had a couple extra minutes, right? I had like bonus minutes, I think, because I drove so far, right? 3:40, so I have like 5 more minutes if you have other questions. Yeah, right down here in front.
I
I'm looking at this plan, and I'm kind of a money guy, as many people probably know. And my concern is if we are going to undertake this community action plan, methods of funding to reach those plans is a rather large concern. And the town of Dalton specifically, our own facilities and such, we're kind of struggling right now to kind of hit those targets.
Budgetary targets.
And I guess to show that the town can get out in front of it and maybe the people of the town would follow, is there any indications that there may be some assistance with these various projects, so to speak?
Yeah, it's a great question. And I mean, you know, frequently we ask people, what are the biggest barriers for implementation? Just for, you know, we don't want to write a plan that sits on a shelf. We want to write one that's actionable. And so always people have at least two barriers. One is capacity, staff capacity to sort of oversee this thing, to make sure that it happens. And the second is money. And they're not always in that order. Maybe they're always in the reverse order. I'm not sure. But it's a great question. So one of the important things is there is funding available for a lot of initiatives. And so I think that becomes really the low-hanging fruit where, for example, just earlier today, we heard about a $25,000 loan, interest-free loan, for battery installation. So underneath $25,000, you can get an interest-free loan from the MassSave program for battery installation at your home or business. So that's one example of funding availability. There are also grants that are available for some of the infrastructure incentive programs that are available. To the extent that we can, if it pencils out, we can also, you know, for some of the larger projects, run financial analytics to see what does, you know, does this actually improve, for example, at a municipal facility, does this particular project actually save the town money over time? And, you know, how do we amortize that to make sure that that happens and so forth? So not every activity probably that will be in this plan will be a cost savings. As a matter of fact, you know, globally speaking, probably mitigating and adapting to climate change will be, you know, a net cost endeavor. I mean, it'll cost some money. But certainly there is some low-hanging fruit, I think there will be for the town of Dalton, that equates to grant programs, cost savings programs, those kinds of things. So it's a great question, very important question. One more from David over here. I'm sorry. Yeah, right here.
So is there any relation between this plan and the roadmap, which is one of six criteria to get elevated from a green community to a climate leader community?
So, yeah, that's a great question. And towns, you know, in Massachusetts are sort of thinking about this and some are pursuing it and so on and so forth. The Climate Leaders Program in Massachusetts has sort of shifted a little bit. And so the actual criteria, while it's stable today, you know, has changed a little bit over the years. There will be, because Massachusetts is coalescing around these kinds of community plans, certainly some of the activities and the strategies that may emerge from this will be parallel to some of the strategies that you might see in achieving, for example, climate community leaders. I think I have the name wrong right now, but climate leaders community status. That does not mean that we will necessarily sort of match, you know, sort of mash that all together for Dalton. It really kind of depends on what's appropriate for Dalton, what you as a community feel like, those kinds of things in terms of the actual strategies. So, I think I see Todd coming up, so maybe I will wrap up and hand the mic back to Todd. But I really appreciate your time and attention and look forward to interacting a little bit more later. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was awesome. I'll let Jack do the intro for David while I'm doing some stuff up here.
Sure. Well, first we wanted to say thank you very much to Rich for all of that, and you know, for coming out and helping so much. And we'd like to introduce David for the intro for the panel discussion. In his professional life, David was a management consultant focused on supply chain and logistics for 20 years. He has an MBA from Texas A&M University and recently completed a master's degree in public policy at UMass Amherst. He's been on the Green Dalton Committee since its inception in 2013, where he currently holds the position of chair and has consistently advocated for Dalton's Green Committee status with the Massachusetts Department of Energy Resources.
Okay, for those of you paying attention to the schedule, it's almost over. So if you just hang in there for a few more minutes. I've got some comments on the things that I've been listening to. I'm chair of the Green Committee. There's six of us in town that have been working on this for the better part of a year. If you're at the town meeting a year ago, you were hit there for the allocation of the $60,000 that was of the town budget that was allocated to support this. And this is the reality of what you guys had voted for. So hopefully you guys will continue to support this kind of stuff. And just comments, just a follow through on my comment there. Doing this in Dalton or doing this in your house is probably not in itself going to save humanity. Dalton is not going to save humanity, but everybody needs to do their part. If everybody does their part, then this thing will go really well. And we can reduce the greenhouse gas emissions that are warming the planet, and hopefully give us a few more years of healthy, productive lives here in Dalton and in the rest of the world. And like I said, I'll focus on doing our part. We do our part with our homes and our energy use. The town is doing its part as far as implementing reduced energy and reducing greenhouse gases. We've already done a few things, probably things that people haven't even noticed. We switched out. We managed this. The state paid for us to switch out our energy-consuming HPS light bulbs in the streetlights for LEDs, and to address some of the financial issues. That is saving the town approximately $60,000 to $75,000 a year. Unfortunately, those savings don't show up in financial statements. They have to be kind. We look at these things as these are not just expenses. These are investments that yield advantages later on. As we spend money insulating in town hall, it's reducing our gas consumption over the next 10 to 20 years or however long town hall lasts. At this point, we'll see what happens. But these things, we're not just looking at spent town money. We're looking to put this money places where we're going to save money. But again, those financials don't show up in those savings don't show up in financial statements. So it's kind of a challenge. You know, we got to keep reminding people that we've been doing things for years. We've been doing things for 10 years already that are starting to get $60,000 a year, I think, is a decent amount of money per year to save. Well, okay. Not on the paper financial statements, and not from somebody who's just picking up a budget document. It's kind of difficult to manage. Like I said, to address Rich's things is the federal government is doing what they can do as far as providing incentives. The state and government is taking those incentives and building upon those, and it's up to us to take advantage of those of the incentive that 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 the state and town are offering in order to implement changes. The good news is you don't have to do them all at once. You can do them, little pieces show progress. And this is my personal experience. 10, 15 years ago, we had CED come in and do an audit, and he brought up a bucket load of LED light bulbs and switch out all of our incandescent, or the incandescent bulbs that were left. They switched them out, and it showed, we saw a noticeable improvement in our electric bill just from switching those light bulbs. Eventually got to a point where our furnace was starting to fail or show its age, so instead of waiting to redo the furnace, the gas-consuming furnace, the GHG-producing furnace, we decided to install heat pumps. When we installed heat pumps, we got a $25,000 interest-free loan to finance that, which more than helped. So we didn't do everything at once. We had solar panels installed on our roof 15, 20 years ago. I guess we were an early adopter, which cut our electric bill in half just right there, which more than paid for the rental that we're paying on us. So the finances and the green stuff are converging to make them advantages. But I guess forms like this are in order to create a context. When you're looking to do home improvements or you're looking to do something in your house, think about the greening of it. And greening is not always more expensive. It's based on incentives from the state and from the community, it's actually less expensive. You get grants, you get rebates, you get tax incentives.
David, thanks for that. Can you start facilitating questions from the audience?
Okay.
Thanks.
Well, okay, now's the fun part. Now's your guys' part to kind of participate.
Can I just say one thing, David? I just want to say one specific to the Berkshires with EVs. I did not mention this, but basically in those cold winter days, which we have more than our fair share, it's very important. Your EV, you can start it by your phone in your garage or outside. You want that EV plugged in, charging on those cold days. You're going to get a better battery distance on that or more mileage out of that. I'd strongly recommend you get a heated steering wheel, heated seats. The heater in an EV takes, in my case anyway, some time versus a combustible engine. So I just wanted to point that out. Two very important considerations on those cold winter days. And to get back to Rich's point and David's point, we have EVs ready to be activated at the CRA. That is close or certainly above $200,000 of infrastructure, which was provided gratis to Dalton via Eversource. There's three new transformers there. We have two poles with four chargers, with the future to include three additional poles and six chargers. So that's planning for the future. We didn't pay a penny for the hardware. It'll be reimbursed through the electric vehicle incentive program that Massachusetts is offering. We will be responsible for software operation and maintenance on a yearly basis via ChargePoint. We own those, we set the rates, so we're not obliged to anyone else. It is a public investment for the public good. And I want to be clear, and as far as level threes, I know Stu, you're looking at Windsor. We also have it in the books that our level three chargers will not cost the town of Dalton a penny. Again, there is money through the IRAs, which if we get a bid, we will sign over credits to that company and it will be gratis. And so there is money out there. We are looking for that, not just with EVs, but I think with other areas too. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Tony. Let me finish that up. You listen to all these presentations, there's probably a lot of dots that connect individually that you people don't understand. So we bring everybody back. Questions that you thought of after the fact or things that you thought of might be important, this is your opportunity to kind of quiz everybody and get kind of some kind of consensus, hopefully, from the people over here. This is a good thing to do. And any questions? Comments? Go ahead. You got a microphone.
I don't know what your extent of the EV trucks and commercial lines that you're aware of, but My company just bought 3 new trucks this year, and the accountant said, hey, look into trying to get some EV or some hybrid type trucks, because there's, as you pointed out, many rebates and incentives. There's days that my guys in their trucks will drive over 600 miles. And we have trailers behind us, which diminish the mileage extremely, especially leaving the Berkshires. We start going uphill. As you pointed out, sucks a lot of power. I don't see in 5 to 10 years you replacing my 550 Dodge Ram dually pickup Cummings with a Cummings in it with 545 horse with an EV that can pull a 16,000 pound trailer with a piece of equipment on it. I don't know how, and I don't know how I'm going to do business in the state of Massachusetts when it comes time that I can't buy a truck or operate in this state.
I don't think anybody's suggesting that you can't buy anything else, but they're incentive then, and it, you come back in a year and maybe the whole the technology for these trucks is changing pretty rapidly. 5 years ago, nobody thought a car was going to go 300 miles, or you know, next year they're predicting up to 600 miles on the car battery. So, and the technology is changing pretty rapidly.
My understanding is with some of the state law that they're trying to force some of the, as they are now even, some of us state contractors are forced into showing that we're adding battery powered equipment into our fleet or our hand equipment. We have to write down what we purchase and what we have in our fleet, showing that we're increasingly becoming more battery backup powered hand equipment. I see eventually the state, when they get to the 2030, that they're going to say you have to have, I mean, they are trying to promote it now by campaigning that we buy EV hybrid type trucks. But in my case, I just, I have to fill out paperwork for them and to say, this is why I can't. I can't drive out to the Cape and back in a day without having to pay my guy that's making prevailing rate working for the state, sitting at a charger for Lord knows how long.
I don't have an answer to that, other than, as David's pointed out, technology is improving and getting better. I'm not that familiar with the larger vehicles. As I said, there's rebates up to $90,000. Oh, yeah. But I know the Ford pickup can tow 10,000. I know it's limited in terms of terrain, and I would hope that technology would improve over time. But it's slowly getting, I believe it's slowly getting there. But remember now, 2035 is the date for new cars and lightweight trucks. Not, I don't know anything about the larger vehicles.
A lot of what's going is there are hybrid electric hydrogen that you can supplement and add a battery or recharge your battery with a hydrogen cartridge that will recharge the battery almost immediately, faster than gas. You just kind of, it's like a battery you plug it in and it moves on, which significantly extends the range of those kind of vehicles. And you come back in 6 months and there'll be something else here, I guarantee you, or in a year, there will be somebody who's addressing those challenges. There are 3,000 moving parts to this addressing climate change. They're all interrelated, and one always affects another, and everybody's aware of that and trying to move as fast as we can and get as much as we've done as soon as possible. So hopefully.
Great question,
that answer
Robert.
Your question? Thank you.
Yeah, something that Dave was saying, or Tony, sorry, regarding the charging at the CRA.
Yes.
When will those be up, and well, how will you set the rate? Do you have any idea what that rate might be?
Yeah. They were installed 2 weeks ago. We have some issues in terms of contract language, taxing in particular, prepayment of services, which is not allowed beyond a one-year period, but that I think we're going to address those shortly. We set
this
the rate.
Is charge point?
This charge point. We have an aggregate rate in Dalton now of approximately 14 cents per kilowatt hour. So we are looking to go to maybe, I think we've set it at 30 cents per kilowatt hour. And when you do charge, if you're charged to capacity, you should be notified on your phone. If you stay in that parking spot beyond the time, you're charged a $3 flat fee per hour. So that's typical of public charging. So we set the rate. It's not going to be a money-making venture. If we break even, if we make something, that's great. It's a public investment. But we set the terms, and, you know, the townspeople would have a say in that. But pretty much our rate is very competitive with any rate in Berkshire County.
Yeah, I've used the Electrify America network, and I think they charge 50 cents, give or take, kilowatt hour. So
yes, yes. Yep.
That
is
for sure. That is a competitive rate. I had another question, more on the climate action plan. So how long has climate action plans been in play in Massachusetts, going back how many years?
I'm not sure. I mean, climate action planning has been a thing probably for the past, 12 to 15 years, dating back to 2010 probably, maybe a little bit before that. I'm not sure in terms of the history of Massachusetts when the first climate action plan was developed, but in general, sort of across the U.S., they started, they're pretty prevalent here in Massachusetts. They're very prevalent in the state of California. Right now, we're seeing a lot there, a lot in the Pacific Northwest, Colorado, and then surprisingly, some of the sort of mid-Atlantic states, North Carolina, South Carolina. But I'm not sure in terms of actual history for Massachusetts specifically. I would imagine about 12 years.
Okay, the reason I ask is as our town goes through this process, I'm going to guess Dalton's not unique in many ways. And we kind of can probably guess what our sources are and what our challenges are. There's probably a town that's, or towns that have already been through and have either succeeded or have met some challenge on the same problems we're about to face, we're about to get some data on. Do you have any success stories, or will the town of Dalton be able to access any data that you have, or like, how do we reach out and leverage what other people have already gone through?
Yeah, some great questions in there. So in terms of leveraging what other people are doing, we always take a good survey of particularly comparison towns. For Dalton, so we look at and are in the process of looking at some other Berkshire communities. I don't recall right off the top of my head who's done them right out here. But we'll also, sort of move a little bit east until we, find others with specific strategies and so forth. In terms of, patterns, what I showed you on those slides is fairly typical. Energy use is usually the biggest, residential, commercial, and industrial energy use, and then transportation is usually second. It depends, town to town will vary on which, if it's going to be residential or commercial and industrial, that's a little bit higher in terms of the energy use. And then strategies that emerge there, anything that deals with your municipality, it's a little bit easier to address directly because you have sort of a relatively small operational footprint, and there are, there's a lot of resources. You can sort of organize those municipal operations to implement those strategies and efforts, whether that's efficiency in buildings or, a solar array on top of a municipal building, those kinds of things. Once you move into the community side of the picture, then things become a little bit more educationally focused. For example, what Tony's been doing, all three of the other panelists have been doing today is sort of promoting particular products, educating about what incentives are available, talking about how to sort of overcome either misperceptions or problems or things like that. Putting other incentives, to the extent that towns and cities have the capability, as David mentioned, to sort of build on what's in place from the state. So those are the types of strategies that we move into once we sort of cross the boundary from municipal to the community side of things.
I'd like to piggyback on that if I could. The other thing that we're trying to do, and this speaks to both funding, which was Bill's question earlier, but also to your question about, well, what, how have people succeeded? What's going on out there? If we become a climate leader town, there's actually a matrix of things we have to accomplish over a certain number of years and check marks and timelines that has to be managed, where we have to jump through those hoops successively to be able to get additional grants. So that's one thing to think about. The other is that there are a lot of dashboards around the state, usually for bigger towns. I'm thinking Cambridge, you know, pretty large.
Worcester has a nice
Worcester,
one.
Yeah, where you can actually look at how the town's doing based on their climate action plan and how they're performing in response to it. So there is data publicly available out there. Smaller towns, it's a little tougher. But again, we have to report. We have to update that data and our accomplishments in the town over time to receive those additional grant money. So we will be communicating that to the public. So we're at four, David. I could put out a feeler for the room. We weren't sure how many people would come. We probably don't need a full hour for our workshop. So if you guys want to keep asking questions, say for another 10 minutes, I'd like to extend that. Are you up for that? Are there other questions out there that you'd like to ask? Anything? You have a question, David? Okay.
I'll ask one of the audience.
Okay.
Liz Locke is here from the FCC Church.
Oh.
What are your challenges over there with that monster of a building?
Well, we do have the Green Congregational Church Challenge. We do have a green committee. We have insulated our building with, I think, 90% reimbursement from the state. We have a community garden, trying to use our green space. We have looked at solar panels and perhaps would like some direction from the town in how to put them in. We did look at a company, but it fell through. We're trying to work hard on our waste management, as much recycling as possible. And thank you for the Dalton Transfer Station for all the, we've noticed how much the Green Committee has worked on that. And I would like to say to the Green Committee, thank you for the lighting in Dalton. I look at it every day, and I'm just so grateful for the low energy lighting.
I have a question for Tony. I am curious about I keep hearing about used EVs, and there are people who are abandoning their Teslas because they hit the expiration of the battery, they just die. And so when they find out it's a $20,000, you know, charge to get new battery in there, they'll just sell it for $2,500 to anybody who wants it. And there are companies springing up all over the country who will just go in, and I guess this is a very technical thing, but they can replace the battery and then recondition the controllers. I don't know all the technology, but for a substantially lower price, you can get into essentially a brand new Tesla. These are in great condition most of the time. So my question for you is, what do you think, I know you don't have a crystal ball, but I'd really love to hear what your thoughts are on, should we be looking for used EVs? Should we start looking?
As I said earlier, to find a used EV is few and far between, aside from a Tesla, probably the most.
Oh, okay.
But getting back to your point about recycling, if you recall, at the senior center, there was a car parked by the dumpster for, oh my goodness, 5, 6, 7 years when this Green Committee was first initiated, and it was in its infancy, EVs. It was a Ford. Well, they just towed that away, and I believe Tom Hutchinson would be better, but I know we discussed it some months ago, but there's a company in New York who took it, or who would have taken it and taken the battery out and recycled it in some manner or aspect. I know from, again, anecdotal, I met a Tesla driver. He's, oh boy, one of the early Teslas, maybe going 10, 12 years, and he's up to 300,000 miles on his Tesla, still going strong. So, you know, battery life is a funny thing. I think there's a lot of factors that play into that. And as the market gets bigger, I imagine there'll be recyclers taking those batteries and using what minerals or components they can. It'll be a business unto itself.
I have a question for Dan as well on PV. Dan, you had mentioned a program that's coming next year, and I wasn't sure if it was state, I think it was state, for solar installation funding. You had just gone to some workshop or something on that. Can you elaborate on that a little bit?
Yeah, there's a lot of money through what is called the Solar for All. It's all through the investment, the IRA, Inflation Reduction Act. So hundreds of millions of dollars went out to various states, and I think Massachusetts got something like $120 or $150 million. I can't remember the exact number. But that money went to the Mass Clean Energy Center, at least some of it, and they are working on basically reviving a version of what was the Mass Solar Loan Program, which, so a big part of the Solar for All specifically is historically the people who have benefited from solar are people that have more money, namely that, you know, that find large tax credits very attractive. So the Solar for All money is specifically trying to, you know, make solar more accessible to lower income homeowners. And so that's what that's really all about. And there's going to be, you know, they're still working on the details and figuring it out. So I'm not going to speak to specifics, but it will be, from what I've heard, it's going to be very attractive. You know, 0% interest type loans or as close to it, and, you know, some buy downs. And I think they're also working on a lease option that would give you a quick path to ownership as well.
Did they say what the timeline was for implementing that program?
2025.
Okay, all right.
I didn't get a specific date, unfortunately.
David?
There are investment programs that are coming online that actually tied the savings that you get from doing the installations to the payback of loans. Green banks and green bonds are establishing payback periods that are consistent with the savings that you realize from doing a solar installation or doing some kind of energy improvement kind of program. They're not quite online yet, but people are in addition to the technology that's changing, the incentives and the financials are changing as well. A little bit of a challenge for six people to keep track of. We're always looking for help if anybody's wanting to help us out. Anyway.
I did want to say that our church did change over to LEDs for all of the lights. And we did sign up with NexAmp, so now we're saving 12.5% on our electricity bill. I just wondered, it hadn't been mentioned at the forum, NexAmp, whether that is a popular tool that people are using in the community.
There's a CCA program, Community Choice Aggregation. If you go on the town website, it'll explain the deal for residential electrics. It's you're automatically enrolled in grabbing electricity from a renewable source rather than from Eversource, according to the contracts that are out there, and those are usually a little bit more aggressive and cheaper than the Eversource standard rates. I don't know if any of you were last year. A few towns in Berkshires were not CCAs and their electricity rates like doubled the last winter. Dalton was fortunate to be in there, and that almost all the residents were able to access the renewable energy portfolio that and ended up holding our rate steady while several of the other communities, you know, went up 60, 70, 80, 90%. So I think stock, I have a friend in Stockbridge who was experiencing that. Read some stories about their electricity rates doubled last year because they didn't have a CCA in place. That's part of what the town is doing to reduce GHG production, that, you know, that we have to do our part, the town has to do their part, the state does their part. And there's some stuff that goes on, and that is no cost to residents to have those contracts put in place. reduces our electricity rates and greens them up, you know, reduces the rates by 40% and 50%. So it's things that you're not even aware of that don't cost any money. They're just out there.
If I could just connect a couple dots here, you mentioned sort of the replacement of some of your fixtures and how that saved you money and some of the best practices. You know, you were sort of talking about what are some best practices, where are people seeing, you know, substantial gains, and this is certainly one of them. Really low-hanging fruit the low-hanging fruit that I mentioned, one of the first things is going to be energy efficiency measures, and lighting fixtures are famously financially attractive because of savings that you mentioned. Every place, of course, is a little bit different because a lot of those, a lot of that early or low-hanging fruit has already been achieved in a lot of buildings, particularly municipal buildings. And so if people are, have been attuned to those kinds of upgrades, retrofits in terms of HVACs, controls, envelope projects, you mentioned insulation, so insulation projects, all of those we put under the category of what we call efficiency measures, and they lower, they just make your building more efficient, and that's where kind of early gains and cost savings can really be tied together. So that's a great illustration. Appreciate it.
And ironically, we have not even mentioned MassSave really pointedly. So there are programs certainly for residential and commercial, right? MassSave does commercial stuff. So they will audit your building and make recommendations and things like that. If we can, just so that we do have some time to do the survey workshop, if we could transition, I was going to turn it over to you, Rich, to coordinate. We have a couple of people who will be helping folks fill them out and stuff, but I just want to leave it with Rich to make this happen. So.